Hey there, welcome to Unwomanly, the podcast where taboo topics are never off the table and discussions with an open mind and dirty mouth are always encouraged. My name is Jen Danczak, and I'm recording in my apartment in West Hollywood, California, and sitting here with one of the biggest fellow Swifties I know. Her name is Alexa Thode. Yay! Welcome to Unwomanly.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm so excited.
Oh, hell yeah, girl. I mean, I've known you for how many years now? Shit.
Well,
5, 6?
Yeah, almost 6 years since I moved out here.
Wow. Yeah. Oh, my God. We always get some cool people at our job that we used to work at. And mm-hmm. So you were one of the cool ones to come through.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I know. I feel like a lot of us still remain friends. So that's nice.
Yeah, we can still see each other and shit. We went to the Taylor movie together. Mm-hmm. So perfect for this topic.
Definitely.
Today's topic is all things Taylor Allison Swift.
Our queen.
I know. It is episode 13, so naturally we had to do it on episode 13. I know, right?
Perfect.
Her favorite number. But I do want to ask you, how did you become a Swiftie?
Well, I feel like I've been a fan of Taylor since her debut. Definitely, Tim McGraw is one of my favorite songs from her, and that's definitely how I got my start into liking her. I was in middle school at the time, so that was like one of my favorite songs. Still is to this day. It's like very nostalgic for me. But yeah.
How old are you again?
I'm 29.
Yeah, so you're 3 years younger. Okay, because I remember it was like high school when I first heard of her.
Yeah, I definitely remember. I have like a memory of talking about her with friends in middle school. So
wow.
Yeah, I know. I feel like I've grown up with her. I think that's what makes my love for her so great, is because I feel like I've literally grown up with her.
Yeah,
like when she was young and naive and a little baby, I was a baby. And when she was like starting to be like, oh, what's this, what's that, I'm like in relationships, confused about love, that was me. And then when she started suddenly talking about drinking, and suddenly she was dropping like the F-bomb and songs.
Oh,
I was like, oh, so am I. Like, it felt like
it was huge.
There's definitely like a parallel with her growing up and my growing up, which I think like adds to my obsession.
I love that.
Yeah.
Did you ever join the whole I hate Taylor bandwagon? Because I won't lie, I was on that at first.
Look, I love Taylor, but I definitely have my annoyances with her. I think she can be like a little, you know, dare I say annoying at times, you know, but I don't think I ever felt out of love with her. I think like maybe there was like a moment of like, okay, too much Taylor, like I need to like you know, listen to other people for a moment. But
yeah,
I think that was kind of when the whole world did that as well,
right?
But I've always listen to her.
I love that.
Yeah,
I think people were just mostly either jealous of her or just like scared of her success as such a young, you know, songwriter, and like judging her. Really, I really think that was really what happened in my hometown, at least, and how everybody was like, who's that, I don't like her, you know. It's like, why don't you like her, you know?
Right.
Once I got older is when I realized like, damn, this bitch is fucking talented and so good, and like, you know, things like that. It took me a long time. I will say it took me a while.
Right. I think it's easy to be annoyed with someone who like is so seemingly perfect. Like,
yes,
she's like pretty, she's like, she's a nice girl, like she has everything. Like,
she can get whatever guy she wants.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah.
So people like can just easily be like, oh, gotta hate her.
Yeah. Which we kind of do with every, like, a lot of celebrities, you know, not just her. It doesn't have to be just her.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah, I can see that for sure. It was 2006 was her first album. I was like just getting into like freshman year of high school, and so that's when I like really heard of her.
Mm-hmm.
And I never really paid attention to her debut album. I was like, I heard, you know, oh, country, whatever. And because growing up in Ohio, I was surrounded by so much country, and I hated it, to be honest. I hated the country music.
Oh, same. That's so funny. I'm kind of the same way. A lot of people in my hometown, I'm from Florida, so a lot of people from my hometown were very into country, and I always was so anti-country, like, growing up. Yeah.
And
but I, now, yeah. What's funny is now that I'm almost 30, I'm like, I kind of like country
Me
music.
Too. I'm kind of the same way.
I'm like, wait, I think I'm just so sick of a lot of music, and like music that's played on the radio these days, it's like all sounds the same to me.
Yeah.
That like, I just randomly started listening to like country radio, and then I was like, well, this is different.
Yeah.
It's different than everything I listened to. And then I started liking it. I've always liked like blues and kind of like folky music. And I think
nice.
The songs that are like kind of more like that. And that's a little bit of Taylor's roots too, is like she can be a little bit like more when she's like at her best, I think, is when she's like very much like singer songwriter, telling yes. a story, kind of like slower.
Yeah.
And a lot, I think a lot of country music has like those roots.
Yeah. And I know she was discovered at the Bluebird Cafe in Nashville. And my brother and his fiance actually live in Nashville now, and I'm so going in a couple of months. I'm so excited to see
Jen,
that place.
I would love to go with you. I've never been.
I've never been.
Oh my God.
I'm so stoked. So that's obviously like number one stop on my list. Like, okay, I want to see where Taylor is discovered, you know?
Right.
A lot of people were discovered there, I think. But she's like obviously the prominent one that I can think of. Mm-hmm. But it was, what's his name? Scott Borchetta, some dude that was, you know, starting his own record label, Big Machine Records. Mm-hmm. And he saw her playing, and like, I guess she was like already having like kind of like a little contract of like just being a songwriter, but they wouldn't give her like an actual album or label. What's it called? Record label.
Contract.
Thank you. A record contract. They wouldn't give her like
sign
a record. They wouldn't sign her. And so she was all like, okay, so I need to, you know, either to go with somebody else or just kind of stick this out. And so he came up to her, I guess, and was all like, hey, you know, I'm gonna start my label, like, do you want to be one of the ones that started off with me? And she took a huge risk, like that's a big risk, and look where she is now.
I think probably her father too played a big role in that. I'm sure he got along with him, and they probably like talked business together. We're like, oh, okay, I can see where this can go. And they're like, yeah, let's do it.
Right, because I mean, she grew up in like a Christmas tree farm in Pennsylvania, little Taylor, and she like convinced her parents to move to Nashville. So she went to like what, Hendersonville High School, and like automatically was like that bitch. Like everybody in school knew who she was gonna be, what she wanted to do, and she set her mind to it. And that's also kind of part of the reason why I think I like her so much. You know, she never gave up on that dream, but obviously it did help having parents that move to a certain city for you, you know?
Yeah, that's like one of the things about Taylor where it kind of drives me a little bit crazy, is like she talks so much about, what was that song? The I Bet You Think About Me song, where she's like, oh, like just kitchen table bills.
Yes.
And like you grew up in Beverly Hills. I'm like, girl, we've seen what your house looked like.
Right.
Okay? Her house. It was a big house.
Yeah, way bigger than mine.
Okay, just because it was a Christmas tree farm.
Right.
And her, you know, daddy knew he was a good businessman.
He was. He
knew what he was
business.
Doing. And they saw, I think they obviously love their daughter, but I think they also saw it as a good opportunity.
Yeah, for sure. And she found her way of like being like, okay, well, I need to actually learn guitar and sing with my guitar and do something different than just a voice, you know? And so she found her little niche. That's for damn sure.
Oh, definitely.
But yeah.
She's always been a good songwriter. I mean, even when you see those videos of her when she was like a little girl, and she's like, you know, she knew she had a way with words always, which is not an easy thing.
I love looking at those old videos. They're so cute. Even my own little old videos, bitch. I'm all like, oh, look at me fucking doing karaoke like a little idiot.
I know. When I was younger, I definitely like had like a little moment where I was like, I want to be a pop star.
Oh, hell yeah.
And like I try to write like music and with my sister, and me and her still like will joke about like little songs we wrote together. They all sound like little High School Musical songs.
Yes. Like, I had like
they're all so funny.
I love that.
Yeah,
I had like a little cassette, and I had like a girl group. It was like me and two other girls, and we were the RCB sisters.
Oh my god,
I know, make it make sense, because it was like Rowdy Calm Both. That's how we came up with like our personalities. That's how we came up with the fucking name. It was so lame, but I still have that cassette and like the CD we made and stuff, but it doesn't play, and I'm so upset. Like I'm like, damn. But at least I still have like the cover art, and like I remember one of the songs, like it's like Hook and shit, so it's just kind of like, okay,
maybe I'll
do something with it.
That's so funny.
I can't, you know, attribute that to Taylor, but she at least kind of propelled that into my adult life too, like, you know what, maybe I still can do this, you know?
No, it's inspiring to like see people who just do it.
Oh, for sure. But I really did want to go through like each individual album. And I mean, we already kind of started with Debut. And I wanted to know what your favorite and maybe least favorite song slash songs on the album were, because that one, I will admit, is probably my least known, like, out of my mind of, like, what songs, you know, pop into my head. Like, I only know a few, you know what
honestly,
I mean?
Honestly, same. I definitely, like, had to, like, think on this one, but right off the bat, Picture to Burn
was
my favorite from debut. But, you know, something I wanted to talk about, too, was I don't know if you remember, she originally had, that was the song that she changed the lyrics to because she said gay.
Oh, she did say gay.
Yes. Yes. But to be honest, I'm like, oh, my God, I loved the original. It was so, like, the epitome of, like, that little teenage angst. Like,
oh,
like,
yeah.
She's saying, like, okay, you're calling me obsessive and crazy.
Yeah.
But I'll tell them, like, my friends, you're gay. Yeah. I'm like, it was just, like, a good, like, little angsty pop song, like, country pop, you know? And that was, like, it was just so fun. I remember, like, obsessing over that song. When she changed it, I was like, ugh.
Oh, God. And but everybody time, said that kind of stuff, you know, back then. They did. Yeah.
I think she was just trying to be like, you know,
PC a little bit.
She definitely wanted to be liked.
Yeah, I get that.
Which is a theme here in her career. But
I know.
But that was like, you know, I think that feeling of like that kind of like, yeah, like F you, like I hate you too, is like, I think why a lot of people started falling in love with her. It's just like that feeling of like, yeah, like, I hate this too. Like I feel that way. So I think a lot of people, it was just like that feeling that people fell in love with.
Yeah. Just another picture to burn. Let's see if I can find a little bit of, like, and even her voice is like old Taylor.
Yes.
She's so young.
By the way,
I don't want to get like. Yes, bitch. Just another picture to burn. Like, yes, bitch. You tell him, bitch.
Yes.
I do like that one, too. Yeah. I mean, obviously, you know, Tim McGraw and Teardrops on My Guitar. Those were the two singles, on that one.
Yeah.
People loved that shit.
Yeah, I still listen to Tim McGraw.
Do you?
Yeah.
I think I hear...
The old faded blue jeans.
Yes, yeah.
When you but I think, like, when she finally releases the Taylor's version of that, I think it's going to be really, really hard for me to only... I don't know, to, like, delete the original because, I saw someone online say, like, Lover is going to be the youngest we'll ever hear Taylor now with all the Taylor's version.
That's
like,
a good point.
I was like, I don't know if I really like that. I like listening to her young voice.
I do, too.
There's just, like, something, like, really nostalgic about it. Yeah. I don't think you can replicate that, and she can't.
No one really can, like, when they do their re-recording.
And so,
like,
yeah, I don't know how I'm gonna feel when
I don't know
because I've deleted most, but
oh, good for you.
This is a conversation for a little bit later, but I have many feelings about the Taylor's version of her, you know, all the re-records are just like,
some I like, some I don't like. Mm-hmm. I will be honest. I want to say out of that debut album, for me, my favorite is definitely Should Have Said No. Mm-hmm. I love
Should Have Said No. That was probably like my runner up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know what it is about that. Like, I know. I think she is the only songwriter on that one, actually. Because the debut album was her, you know, she wrote her songs with someone else and she got like shit for it. So when she was writing her next album, she wanted to do it all by herself. But Should Have Said No, actually, she was the only songwriter on that, I believe.
Interesting.
But that one is so fucking good because she just, like, tells it to their face, like, just like Picture to Burn. Like, you know, you shouldn't have fucking done anything with her. Like, I'm going to find out, dumbass, you know?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
That was so, I loved
it. Should have said no. Should have gone home. Should have thought twice before you let it all go. Yeah, it's just a bop.
It's so good. It's such a bop. Like, I can't believe that one is so underrated, man. Yeah. So fucking good. Like, there's some on that album, like, I've never even, like, paid attention to. Like, that Mary song.
I know, I was kind of listening to them today, but like, so one of the things when I was trying to figure out like my least favorite, I put Invisible, but I'm also just like, it's because a lot of her debut songs, they all sound like demos to me.
I can get
like,
that.
They just sound like songs that like she kind of just recorded real quick.
Yeah, that makes sense.
They're all very young. You know, you can tell that they're like, you can tell it's her debut album, you
right
know?
Right, yeah, no, for sure songs. Yeah, there's definitely more that I don't care for than I do care for, but not because they're not good. I think I just didn't give them the time of day that I know I have the other albums.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah,
yeah. So that one, yeah, definitely an interesting one. I do love A Place in This World.
I don't know what I want, so don't ask me.
I like that one a lot. That's definitely one of my favorites.
And she also had like such a country twang in this album.
Yes. And I like
it's
that.
It's so cute.
I do
so
like
cute.
That. So I, like you said, I am very curious what this re-recording is going to be like.
I know. Because even in Fearless, she, with the re-record, she kind of lost her twang a little bit. And that was like one of the things I kept seeing people talk about.
Yes.
Was like, we don't have it anymore. I'm like, where's the accent? I'm like, no, don't lose it.
Right. What do you think about our song? I want to say that's probably one of my top ones.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely. Because, I mean, it was such a hit.
It is such a hit.
And, again, one of the songs that made her a star.
Oh, yeah. Know? Yeah. I like those better than the Teardrops. And
that was
the
also
Timid
one
Rock.
Of my surprise songs when I went to the Airs.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. Which was so cute because I actually, when I got there, one of the girls next to me gave me a bracelet that said our song on it. And then that night she sang it. And I literally like almost started crying. I was like, oh my God, this girl's probably so pissed she gave it away.
That's
I was like,
so
I'm
funny.
Keeping it.
You're like, sorry, bitch.
I'm like, it's mine now.
Oh, that is funny.
But yeah, so it definitely has a special place in my heart now, for sure.
Damn, that's awesome. That's actually a really good story. But yeah. But album two, let's be real, this is where she really started to pop off. And this was Fearless in 2008. Man, like you look at this little list and you're like, Jesus, okay. One of the ones that is one of my top ones. Mm-hmm. And it was not a single, but it's Tell Me Why. Mm. I love Tell Me Why.
I do love that song.
Ugh, fuck. And like, she did have a co-writer on that one. I really do want to like play that one real quick. Yeah, here we go. Let's see. Tell Me Why. I just love the beginning. Like, it just really says it all. I took a chance. I took a shot. And you might think I'm bulletproof, but I'm not. You took a swing, I took it hard. And down here from the ground, I see who I am. Sick and tired of your attitude. I'm feeling like I don't know you. Love me and cut me down. And here's to you and yourself for yourself. I remember what you said last night. Like, why did you do that to her?
I know, that's a good one.
Like, this album was where Love Story came from, and that's obviously probably her most famous song ever. Ever.
Definitely. I remember that song being on the radio like 1,000 times a day for probably like 2 years straight.
Oh, like, yeah.
I couldn't turn on the radio without it being played.
Yeah, that was...
It was so big.
15 as well. Love that one.
I kind of... I'm not really
You're not a 15
fan.
One?
No,
You're not a
15 not.
Fan?
It's a little like...
it's super high school-y.
Yeah, it's a little too like... Disney kitty. Kids bop for me a little bit.
Kids
I don't know.
Bop. That's know. So funny.
It was just like, I think, I don't know. I didn't like it back then, I think, because it was just like too...
Yeah. Yeah.
Too much. I'm a kid.
Yeah. No, I get
but
that.
Yeah. I don't know. Maybe now when I listen to it, it would be better, but I'm just not. But, you know. Yeah. My favorite song, though, is Hey Steven. Okay, cool. It's because I feel
so
like it's
good.
An unpopular song.
So
not a lot of
underrated.
People know that song.
Yeah, that one is
I
so good.
I love it so much. It's just like, I feel like it's such a good song. Like,
it
when you're
is.
Crushing on someone, it's just like, it feels happy. It feels like,
yeah.
This is what it feels like when you get that little serotonin
yeah.
boost when you have a
yes.
crush on someone, you know?
And that was the first time she ever, like, mentioned somebody by name in, like, a song, you know? Mm-hmm. And everyone was like, who's Steven? Who's Steven?
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Or what was the song that she mentioned, Drew? Maybe that was
Oh,
before.
Fuck. Yeah, you're right. Teardrops on My Guitar.
But I don't think she named. Julek. But this, I think, maybe the first one she actually named.
Yeah.
Her song.
Yeah.
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 It's
good
a
point.
Good one.
Hey, Steven's so good.
I can feel this magic I've been feeling since I met you. Can't help it if there's no one else. Ooh, I can't help myself.
Oh,
It's such a, it's just like cute.
It is. Cutesy. Yeah. Hey, Steven, I know looks can be deceiving. I love that line. Yeah. It's like, ooh, is he ugly?
I know. Oh my God, I never thought about that.
Oh yeah, I love that part. That shit's funny. Oh my
God. She's like, I know you're ugly, but...
But you're kind of cute to me.
But I'm into you.
I love that.
Oh my God. I don't know why I've never even realized that. Yes. That's so funny. But honestly, girl, same.
I've had
a crush on like some ugly people. And I look back and I go, what the hell is wrong with me?
Oh, 1,000,000%. Why was I into that? Just had a crush, but full blown slept with these people. And I'm like, what was I know. Thinking? Like,
I don't know. Yeah. Oh, yeah. It really goes to show you it's all about the hormones.
Oh, yeah. Like, oh, yeah. Definitely. I will say, like, her top, like, one of her, like, what's it called? Like, actual singles from that, like, You Belong With Me. Mm. I do like You Belong With Me.
I like it more now than ever. Really? I think it's because, again, I don't know. I'm just one of those people, I've never really been that into her singles. I'm always like, you have to listen to the album.
Yes.
The album songs are always so much better.
So much better.
And so, I don't know, maybe it's just like me being like, I'm anti-singles.
I'm glad you say that. Yeah.
But they always just feel like a little like... too try hard for me, like, yes. Like clearly the label is like, this one will do.
Yep.
But they're not like her best songs in my opinion.
Yeah. No, yeah, definitely.
But I do love Fearless. It's just like, yes. I feel like definitely embodies the album as a whole.
Yeah, Fearless is so good. Definitely.
And it's fun. It's funny. I just picture her like shaking her little gold frilly dress like while singing it,
twirling around. Yeah, that one's fun. A good one. That one's a good.
Forever and Always too. Oh my God, do you remember that? Like that's like infamous because that was the one that she wrote about Joe Jonas, but she like recorded it last minute to put it on the album because she already had her album like done, but Joe Jonas had just broken up with her, and she was like, wait. I need to put this one song on
there. No fucking way.
Yeah.
And by the way, no, I did not know that.
Oh my God, yeah.
But he did break up with her in what? Like a 28-second phone call? Like voicemail or some shit even?
27-second phone call.
Yep. Unreal.
She was petty and bitter.
Man.
You said forever and always.
Yes. Joe Jonas. Sir, what are you doing?
Also, I was obsessed with the Jonas Brothers at the time, too. So, this was like... This was my Roman Empire at the time, you know. I was like obsessing over like every single detail. I'm like, I cannot believe this happened.
I can't believe you would do this.
This is crazy.
And now she's like besties with his ex.
I know. I know. I love it so much.
We love to see it. We love girl power.
I know. And the pettiness of it too.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Oh definitely. But then like
Forever and Always was a good song though.
Yeah. That one, honestly, that one I do remember only like the hook. I'm not gonna lie. But there's
raising the moon, everything's wrong. Raising your hand, rain when you're gone.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. That's ringing a bell for sure. Yeah. I just remember
forever and always.
I just remember that part. That's literally it.
Yeah.
There's other ones I don't even know. Like I do not know The Way I Loved You that well, or
that's
like
the
You're
way
Not Sorry.
I loved you.
Oh no. I do know that part. Okay. The Other Side of the Door. I've never heard of that one.
The Other Side of the Door. I don't know.
I love how you do. Oh, that's so funny.
Coming with the Rain was kind of a...
Yeah. Untouchable or Jump Then Fall?
Untouchable was a like really cutesy, slow like bonus track.
Oh, okay. Got you. Breathe was... I remember the beginning of Breathe more than anything. I can just hear like the guitar right now.
Yeah, remember that was when Colby Calais was like... popular
coming
too.
Out
it's
yeah
funny
doing
see,
her thing yeah
see featuring Colby. What happened to her?
I know. What's she doing nowadays?
I know.
Colby, what you up to, girl? Yeah, there's White Horse was, I remember White Horse was a good one.
Yeah. Oh yeah, that was a, I remember Stephen Coletti was in the music video for that, the guy from Laguna Beach. Yes.
Let's play a little bit of Fearless just because like come on, it's fucking Fearless. Mm-hmm. like how do you not love this? Let's see.
Yeah.
We can come in at any point of any song. Yeah. And we know where it's at. Good shit. Let's see.
I don't know how it gets better than this. Drag me head first, fearless.
Like, yes, bitch. Good for her. Yeah, and I love that album color with her, like, a color album cover with, you know, how her hair is just blowing everywhere because it's just like, yes, bitch, because everyone knew her by her, like, blonde hair and curls, you know?
R.I.P. to the curls.
R.I.P. to the curls. You're so right. Yeah.
I do love her hair now, though, but, the curls were iconic.
Damn. Yeah, you're so right, man. I do want to talk about her Taylor's version now because... Mm-hmm. Let's be real. Fearless Taylor's version came out, what, 2 years ago now at this point? And that was the first time, I believe, that
was that
we,
the first one she released?
I think that was the first one she released, re-released. So the reason why she had to do these re-recordings, let's get into that shit, is Scooter fucking Braun, who pretty much is a, I guess he's a powerhouse in the music industry, or at least was, because things are going to definitely come to light that Taylor's been hinting at for years. And you can tell by all
it's kind of slowly happening.
Look at all of like Eric,
all these people dropped him.
He's the manager of what, Ariana Grande, Justin Bieber, Demi Lovato. They've all dropped him as their manager. Why else would they do that? He did some crazy shit. I think
there's a big lawsuit coming, right?
Oh girl, it's going to get nasty. Yeah. It's going to get nasty. But anyway, so this man who's pretty much, you know, had his hand in a lot of things in the industry, and has a lot of power and a lot of money, bought her masters. And that was a huge scandal in, what, 2019? Yeah, around then. And so she claims that she was never told about this at all and, like, never offered to purchase them at all. Obviously, there's, you know, three sides to every story. But it's one of those things, like, her artwork, her life is taken out from underneath her. So she was like, you know what, bitch? I'm going to fucking re-record this shit and I'm going to re-own it again. And I give her so much credit.
And also to Scott Porchetta, or Bruschetta.
Yeah, right.
Whatever, however the hell you say his name.
Yes, Porchetta.
He threw her under the bus. Like,
where's the loyalty? I mean,
he literally was with her since she was like 14 years old. And then all of a sudden he's like, oh yeah, here.
Yeah.
Take them.
Look at all this money. Look at all this money.
As if she wouldn't want them. But I do wonder, I wonder, like you said, there's three sides to every story. I wonder what the actual truth of the situation is, because I do feel like sometimes Taylor can play a little bit of like the victim card sometimes. And I'm like, I wonder what really went down.
Yeah.
Because I think they claim, I think, didn't they claim that they did?
Yeah, they claimed that they,
And I think that she just,
yeah,
I think she thought it was a bad deal.
Right. I did.
But now she's saying that it's like, no, I was never.
Yeah.
But I don't really know what the truth, who knows what the truth is.
I've been hearing things that, like, she allegedly was given the option to release a new album and she would get an old album back. So it was just a never-ending cycle is what I'm hearing from that. And then I also heard that her dad actually was kind of like told, like, something was gonna happen and you want to be on this phone call, but he was like, well, you know, due to, like, you know, conflict of interest, like, if it's about my own daughter and I can't say anything, I don't want to be a part of that phone call. So I heard that part too. So yeah, she riled up the troops, man, and everyone fucking hates Scooter now.
I know.
And man, and the things she has written on this, on her newer albums, man, ooh, everyone knows who it's about. And
yeah,
very, very curious what's going to come and happen. But
I mean, this is like a whole different story, but I don't think, like, I see like Justin Bieber and I think like bad things have happened to him.
Yeah.
I don't, he doesn't look well. And I just don't think that Scooter Braun as like his manager, as a manager, as a whole, is like not, he's not good.
Scooter,
like,
was,
I
part of the,
I think he does like
sketchy
things.
Yeah.
And so I think that's how, you know, he came
to
his success. But
yeah,
I think it's all kind of catching up to him now.
Definitely. I mean, his wife divorced him. Wonder what that's about.
Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, Fearless was definitely the first one she, I don't know if it's the first one she re-recorded, but it's at least the first re-recording that she released. And she, with her re-recordings, releases From the Vault tracks. And I will say, bitch, I'm so fucking thrilled. I'm so thrilled that she was actually able to do this. Like, and we can hear all these songs that she's just been kind of sitting on for years. Like, that's a whole new opportunity to, you know.
I know. I do sometimes question, this is just me playing devil's advocate, do you think some of those are actually vault tracks, or do you think that she just kind of wrote it in the vein of that album? And
right.
And it's like, yeah, this is,
like
song from back then,
like part of like the 10-minute version. We'll get to that. But I'm kind of like, is that actually when you wrote that?
Yeah, like, I don't know, like, if I fully believe that story.
I don't know. But yeah, I guess we'll. It would we'll be never cool. Know.
I think some of them are.
Yeah.
Like, also, like, again, we'll get to it. But like with 1989, I think some of those mm-hmm. are vault tracks, and I think some of them are.
I get that.
I do not believe that Slut was written back then. I just don't.
Yeah, but I get that, girl.
We'll get to that.
Yeah. But I will say with the Fearless from the vault tracks, oh, my God. Mr. Perfectly Fine. Mm-hmm. Hello.
I know. That was a good one.
We another all know one who about that's about.
Joe Jonas. Yep.
Joe Jonas trying to act like everything's fine. Mm-hmm. And she's fucking crumbling into pieces over your ass. Yeah, right. That one was a good one. It was like, okay, how many times can she like mention this in the same song? Mm-hmm. You know, that was actually kind of good. Like, that was a good one. I love Maren Morris. Big fucking fan mm-hmm. of Maren Morris. So the fact that she was on You All Over Me, I do like one.
I know.
When I saw her name, I got so excited.
I know. I love Maren Morris too.
She's fucking good. But I want to say, out of all the vault tracks, my number one is That's When. Mm-hmm. Like, I play that one a lot.
I'm glad you said that.
Keith Urban, baby.
That's when. I didn't wake up in the morning. That's when. It just sounds like that album.
It does. One does.
That's one that I feel like, okay, yeah, that's definitely from that era.
Yes. That one's definitely a good one. I wanna play a little clip of that one because that one's fucking good. Let's see. I just love it. Okay, let's get this. I don't know. It's just so good. Like, mm-hmm. and it works out well with Keith Urban, too. I mean, all these, you know, old school country folk, you know.
Right. It just sounds like a real classic song. Yeah.
That one definitely does sound very Fearless. Mm-hmm. But there's a couple of those from the vault that I never listened to. Like, yeah, We Were Happy or Don't You, Bye Bye Baby. I could not tell you what those are. I don't know why.
Yeah, I don't think I was a fan of Bye Bye Baby or We Were Happy.
Yeah. Is Today Was a Fairy Tale a vault track, or is that like...
That was a bonus song. That was actually what I put as my least favorite.
Really? How
it's
funny.
It's just too, like, I don't know, kids. Again, yeah. Kids bop.
Kids bop.
Sounds like a Disney soundtrack song.
Like, I feel like I'm looking at an NSYNC lyric.
Today was a fairy tale, you and you.
Oh, okay, yes, yes. Yep.
Yeah, it was just a little too much.
Yeah.
Too much for me. Too Disney.
I get that. I totally get that. But I was just so grateful that these fucking vault tracks were becoming a thing. It made me so happy.
I know.
But yeah, let's move on to album 3. Speak Now. I know, right?
What a great album.
Bro.
What a great album.
2010, beginning of a new little decade. Started yes. out purple as fuck mm-hmm. with this album, man.
Great album. Horrible re-record. That's what I'm really? Gonna say. I stand by it. When I listened to that, I was like,
really?
I hate the Taylor's versions of this album with a really? Passion.
Really?
Because she was so annoying and angsty in this album. Better Than Revenge.
Oh my God, that's the one I was just gonna say. That is the one that pisses me off. I want to say.
I literally threw my phone when I listened to that. Dead. I was like, come on, girl.
I read it on the internet that she changed the lyric, and I was like, there's no way she's changing the lyric. And then she changed the lyric.
And girl, that's all you could think of. Girl, a moth to the flame.
Girl, like, it's okay. I get it that you're trying to be like.
I know she wanted to rhyme.
She doesn't want to make it slut shame. She doesn't want to slut shame.
Who cares?
Right, like
Paramore did it too. Like, okay, you can just say like, okay, that was young and stupid and naive, but still sing the song.
Right, right.
But like that song in general was a big like,
girl.
Music doesn't have to be politically correct all the time.
No.
Like, she's having a moment, and like, listen, we've all been there where you're pissed off and you're like, just want to call a girl, you know, a slut maybe that's not being totally like feminist of me, but like in your most heated moments of life, you're gonna have those dark thoughts.
Damn straight.
And I think that song is the epitome of that.
Yeah.
Those feelings of saying like, oh God, I cannot believe this bitch took that guy from me. Yep. I can't believe it. And she was angsty about it. And that's why that one of that that song in general is like such an iconic song. And then to change it.
To change it. Girl,
she's
why?
Like calling her, you know, a slut. Like she's like saying like, yeah, you all like you're all better known for the things that you do in the mattress. Yes. Like, but it's like we all have the. You know, when girls get together, they're sipping their wine. You have those moments where you talk shit.
Yep.
And so to like to she's not be actress. Truthful and honest about those moments, I'm like, that's why we love you, Taylor.
Right.
It's because she has those moments where you're like, yeah, she's not perfect. She does like, you know, bitch a lot in her songs.
Right.
But and that's okay. That's what made her famous, though, is that because girls can relate to those feelings of when you're just like annoyed.
Like that people are taking your guys. Like if you're dating someone and a girl takes her, of course you're gonna be so pissed off.
You're gonna have those moments. And so I think I think it's an honest song. And so to change it, I think, is disappointing.
Yeah.
Just because you wanna be like, you know, politically correct and like a feminist
or try to be a little bit more of a role model to younger people or something. But it's like, dude, it's okay. Like that fucking song was iconic. That was one of my favorite ones on that album.
I mean, I guess if you really want to be like problematic, you can just listen to the old version, but
but it's still
but
so
it's
good.
Like, what if I still want to support you and you know, listen to like that lyric? I don't know.
Yeah, is it bad that like I do listen to the original more than this one?
I know. Well, I still do too, because I mean, because at first I was like, okay, I need to delete.
Right.
Because everyone online was like, okay, delete. Like, that's what you do.
Yeah.
The Taylor's version came out and then you delete the album. So I started doing that and I kind of regret it now because I'm like, some of these are just like, I'm like, ugh. Like,
I know.
Because I noticed the little things.
Me too. Oh, me too.
The background sounds will be different.
Yep. Like, if she's using a different mic or something.
Yeah. You can just, you just can't replicate the production in a lot of these.
Oh yeah, no, for sure. You'll hear like certain little notes that are different. Or
Haunted
like,
doesn't. I think Haunted sounds horrible too, and that's another one of my favorite songs. But I feel like in Fearless, though, I will say the re-records, I didn't notice it as much.
Oh, okay. I think you're
and
right.
And I have
that.
A feeling, and I was talking about this with my sister actually, and she thinks that as she started releasing the re-records, she probably was starting to get maybe threats from like Scooter's lawyers.
That you need to change more.
That you need to like sound more different.
Yeah.
Because with Fearless, it sounded pretty
almost exact.
Yeah. Pretty good. Like it sounded, how it originally did. And then I feel like with Speak Now, it was like immediately like, nope, I notice all the little things.
Bitch.
So I don't know. That may be why.
Yeah.
But I just think in general, Speak Now, the album, she was very angsty.
Yeah.
And I think that like, in that moment, that's just where she was in life. She was annoyed with everyone.
Yeah.
She was annoyed with Joe. She was annoyed with all these people. And I think going back and re-recording it, she just couldn't replicate that passion.
I get that. No, totally. I mean, there's probably so many other factors playing into it, like getting the right people, getting the right, you know, not really co-writers, I guess, but, you know, just anyone who can play a certain instrument or like can actually like get all those little things in the background perfect. And I can only imagine the stress. You know what I mean? But man, like I will say Innocent is probably one of my favorites. That one is allegedly about Kanye West and how he went up on stage and, you know, made a fool out of her back in the day. Because she's like 32 and still growing up now.
Oh, yeah.
And he was 32 when he did it.
I know, which is crazy to think.
I know. I'm literally 32 right now. That's so
wild. I know.
So wild, man.
We're like, you know, when that happened, we're like, oh, wow, he's an old man.
Yeah. Yeah. But dude, one of my other favorites, Mean. Love Mean. Mm-hmm. She won Grammys for that one for sure, and rightfully so. That song is so fucking good. That one I thought was about Kanye, and it's not. That one's about some writer.
Some critic.
Yeah, some critic that was just, you know, fucking being an asshole about her. Yes, yes, girl. Such a good one. And I love her twang in that one.
Mm-hmm.
All you are is mean. And she's
the
just like,
banjo.
Yes, the banjo, honey. Banjo. Yeah.
All you are is mean. And a liar, and pathetic, and alone in life, and mean, and mean.
It's just so good, bitch. And then I love the clapping. Like, yes, girl.
Yes.
Such a good one. Man, really? I'm not going to lie. I'm not a big fan of the title track, Speak Now. I don't know what it is about Speak Now. I feel like it's maybe too wordy or something.
That's the one where she's like singing about the wedding
or whatever. Yeah.
It's a little too like story time for me.
I get that.
I get that. My favorite though is, and probably like everyone's favorite, is Enchanted.
I love Enchanted. That one's a feel good one for sure.
It's just like, I feel like perfectly exemplifies like Taylor Swift and her fandom.
And
like,
a princess.
It's just like this hopeless romantic imagination, maybe a little Delulu.
Yeah.
Like her and all her fans are like that. And it's like, you know, you see it in her Eras Tour movie. Like it's just, it's the only one she sings from Speak Now, which I kind of find weird. But
you're so right.
I know. I was, huh. What weirded me out too is that, like, even on the extended version on Amazon, they still didn't release more Speak Now.
Like, why was Long Live in it?
Oh, wait.
No,
is that Speak Now?
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Long Live?
Yeah, it is, yeah.
Oh, okay, maybe. Never mind.
Long Live.
But still, at the tour, it's like just Enchanted.
Yeah, it's like, why is that the
everyone else, all the other eras get like more songs.
So many more. But
this album, I think maybe she just feels like they're all a little problematic for her.
Maybe.
So she doesn't want to go back.
But how come Debut had zero? Notice that? Not a single song from Debut was in that set list.
Do you think it's because she doesn't have
records
from it?
Right, that's
what
I'm wondering.
She didn't want to even like give into it?
Right, that's what I'm wondering too.
It's almost like she was like, I don't want anyone to be interested in those songs, so they don't listen to them.
Just yet. Yeah, no, I can get that.
But Reputation, she has to, because obviously.
Bitch.
She's like, I have.
I don't even want to get started on Reputation yet, bitch. Oh, I'm going to lose my shit. But no, dude, like, I will say mine is such a good one. Love mine.
Back to December.
Oh my God, Taylor Lautner.
Video was so cute too. Walking through the snow and all that.
She wasn't afraid to admit when she was wrong. And you know, like, Taylor Lautner was allegedly like, isn't that crazy?
It was like her first time
admitting
that she was
the one in the wrong. Yeah. She's like, sorry, I didn't mean to hurt you. Like, I would go back to that time if I could, you know? And I'm so glad that they're friends still and they're friends now. And
I know.
That's awesome. And he's married to another Taylor.
Like, I know.
How many Taylors? I just can't.
Although I do find it, I follow them both. And like, I think she, the wife, she like posted a video of like their anniversary.
I love
that. And then I had like a Taylor Swift song on top of it. I was like,
I love that they're all friends.
I was like,
that's so great.
This is a little low-key weird.
It is a little low-key weird.
Right. But she's such a Swiftie that she's just like, I don't really give a fuck.
I love
that. I'm like, girl, same.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's so true. Like, I would too, bitch. I would freak the fuck out. Let's be real.
And that girl was just like a nurse. She was just like a normal person. Now look at her. She has like a podcast with him. She's hanging out with Taylor Swift.
Dude, that's so wild. And what's funny is he's like such a big like Detroit Lions fan. Like,
oh, really?
I love that. Yeah. Like, my whole family is huge Detroit fans. I'm not sure if he's from Detroit. That would make sense if he was, but.
Oh, weird, interesting.
Huh? Yeah, I know, right? Hmm. I love him.
That would make sense because I feel like he has a little bit of an accent.
Oh, okay. So, I do not. I'm not going to lie. Like, this is definitely probably one of my more favorite albums just because I do love so many of the songs on it.
And then also we have to talk about John Mayer.
John!
And dear
fucking
John.
Fucking Mayer. The second or third time now that she's mentioned a dude's name by his name. And that was,
and
oh
what
my
a moment
God.
In time for all of us.
What a moment.
Dear John. So she spilled it. She said, you.
Yeah.
Let everyone know
that
you're a creep.
Yeah.
And you fucking played me.
I was,
and
only
I was
19.
Young.
Like, don't you think 19 was too young? Like, hello.
And also, that song is just so good.
It really was. Dear John, I see it all now that you're gone. Don't you think I was too young to be messed with? But a girl in the dress cried the whole way home. You should have known. Oh, it's so good, bitch. What do you think of this re-recording now? Like, it doesn't sound exact.
Even that little bit, that little instrument sounded
it
off.
Sounded so different. Yeah. Because then you listen to this. Yeah. It just isn't the same. Yeah.
It's so minor that only, like, the hardcore Swifties
right?
were, like... But it's like you're recording it for your hardcore Swifties,
right.
And it's like we're the ones who are noticing these little things. And I'm like, it sucks because I want to be so supportive of her, but
I know.
But I'm like a sucker for like nostalgic
nostalgia and just like, yep. I want to hear the OG songs.
Oh no,
and
I get it.
Sucks because like one of my best friends is like, what do you mean you haven't deleted all of them? Like you're a Taylor fan and you haven't deleted all them. God. I'm like, please.
Is it crazy that I haven't deleted a single one? Uh oh.
No, like, now I mean, feel like a bad person.
I get it. And I bet you, I mean, if Taylor ever heard this, please don't hate us for liking some of the old ones. Okay, we love you.
I know.
But we still like your
original music.
Right. Okay. We just, you know, yeah.
One of my friends said, like, it's better if you just buy it. That way you don't get he doesn't get the streaming.
Okay.
And I'm like, oh,
interesting.
Good to know. But I'm like, I don't know. I have Apple
Music.
Didn't
even think about that one. Huh. Yeah, I'm not. I do like The Story of Us. The Story of Us is good.
Oh, yeah. So good. In that video, another one about John Mayer.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Apparently, it's supposed to be about seeing him at an awards show.
Okay.
And she's like singing about like we saw each other and like we're just sitting here. And, like, we're acting like we don't know each other.
Right. Makes sense. Isn't that crazy how that always happens in relationships? You're strangers. Then you become amazing friends. And then all of a sudden you're strangers again. Like, I know. Fuck that, man.
I know.
Ugh.
And that video was so cute. She's, like, just, like running around, just, like being acting crazy and just, like,
I don't even know
her little
seen
school
that
outfit. Oh. She's, like, in a school and she's, like, freaking out.
I'll have to definitely watch that one. Yeah.
It's fun.
Last Kiss or Never Grow Up. I don't really know those much.
Last Kiss was like the one about Joe Jonas.
Mm. She's probably pretty much saying
like she talks about like a date. I remember was it like December or no, July? Okay. Oh, that July 9th.
July 9th.
And that was like what she was like paparazzied with him. Like,
July 9th was a huge day in Eras tour fandom.
Yeah.
That's so funny, bitch.
Yeah.
Ours, I only really know Ours because like my roommate loves Ours. So
I know. And that was like a bonus track that I think she came out with a little bit after.
Yeah.
But it was sweet. I liked that song. I listened to it a lot.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. No, that was that album, solid. I love the purple theme. I love the princessy theme, but also I'm going to call out you, bitch, and she doesn't care. Like, I do love that album. But let's talk about the Taylor's version vault tracks from that one. Okay. Bitch, I Can See You. Incredible.
Yes, this was, I feel like when I was like, okay, she finally has like some good vault tracks.
Yes.
I Can See You is a great.
I Can See You is my number one, definitely. And that one was actually one of my surprise songs at my concert that I went to.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I was so excited about it.
Lucky.
It was so good. Yeah, that one was good. And that's the one where...
that's so fun.
And that's the one where everyone realized that Taylor and Taylor Lautner were still close because she had him in the music video for that. So that's fucking dope. And when that one was actually played, I was like freaking out because I think it was like just re-released when I went to that concert. I'm not a big fan of like Castles Crumbling or Foolish One.
I'm not a fan of Electric Touch. The
I kind of like that one. Okay. Like that's my number two. But the rest of them, I couldn't tell you.
Yeah. I honestly, I just had to like look this up because I was like, wait.
Yeah.
What were the ball tracks?
But, right.
Yeah, I feel like the only one I really listen to now is just I Can See You.
Yeah, that one's bomb. That one definitely, I feel like, you can always tell when, like, some of them were, like, paid attention to more in the re-recording process, you
know? Also, that's the only vault track, I think, that she's recorded a music video
exactly.
to, right?
I think so.
I don't think she's done that for anything else.
I think you're right, yeah. Everyone thinks that When Emma Falls in Love is about Emma Stone.
Yeah.
Yeah, because they're friends.
I think one of them confirmed it, I think.
Oh, okay. Right? Interesting.
I think maybe Emma Stone did. I don't know.
Yeah. See, everyone who thinks that Taylor only writes about boys, fuck off. She writes about other people, okay?
No.
Yeah. Good album. Solid. Big fan.
Mm-hmm.
Glad she now owns it with Taylor's version. So.
Yeah.
Let's do album 4.
Woo!
Girl, I will say, this is Red. Red from 2012, baby. This is when I really started paying attention to Taylor.
Okay, yes.
Yeah, I would say I was like, holy shit, okay.
This was good. Like my favorite era for a very, very long time.
Yeah.
I feel like it was like my peak obsession.
Yes. Okay.
And yeah, it's like, I feel like she was like such like an autumn girl during this. And like, I am an autumn girl. And like, I just loved it so much. And I think she finally was just like, okay, like I'm just going to be a little bit more like singer songwriter. And I always, for the longest time, I think up until like Folklore came out, mm-hmm. I was like always telling people you need to go listen to Red because those were like her like slower songs. And I'm like, if you're not a fan of her, like maybe listen to this
yes.
album because it was just so good. Yeah. Which is funny because the singles, again, are like not my favorite songs from the album.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
They're vastly different than.
Oh, yeah.
Than the rest of the album.
It's insane, actually, how different mm-hmm. they are. Oh, for sure. Like 22, of course, a bop. Mm-hmm. But like, because she yeah. has, you know, Max Martin and Shellback, like doing those, and they've done like Britney Spears songs and all those, you know, poppy people. And like, obviously, it's going to be a hit. 22 was mm-hmm. great. I think it came out when I was around 22 as well. Yeah. So that was kind of cool.
Yeah. And this was like also like right when like everyone knew she had written a lot of these songs about Jake Gyllenhaal.
Yes.
And then like she came out with We Are Never Getting Back Together.
Yeah.
And that was just like this big like radio anthem.
Big,
like
huge.
Everyone was like listening to that. So
yeah, every girl was like, you know what? Fuck you.
Yeah. It was like, I feel like such a big deal when she released that song. So
yes.
I was like, ooh, she's talking about it.
Yeah. No, that was such a good one.
But of course,
oh, she's best gonna song. Say it. She's gonna say it.
Best song, I think, dare I say, from all of her albums
yes
that she's ever recorded
yes
is All Too Well,
and I just got the chills. Yep. So
favorite
good.
Song of all time, probably.
So fucking good. Like you I mean, can't top it. Like, and it wasn't even a single, and I love that she listened to her fans.
Yes,
yes.
And I'm it's crazy to me because a lot of people, I don't know, maybe I'm just not friends with too many Swifties, mm-hmm. but every time I would mention this song to somebody, they'd be like, I don't really know that song.
Yeah.
And I would always be like, this is my favorite song, you have to listen to it, please. Right. Please, please. And so I feel like it's funny that it didn't really catch on for like years.
No, it really
because
didn't.
Because when did she, I don't know when the 10-minute version came out, but even during like Lover, I feel like I think Lover era is when she started being like, hey, you guys are asking me to sing this song a lot. But it's just like an incredibly emotional song.
Yeah.
It's so well written.
Yes.
I feel like it's storytelling at its best, but it just she perfectly knows how to explain like what it feels like to be like, okay, like this is what happened, like this was what our relationship was like, where did it go wrong,
right.
And so I just, it's just such a well-written song. I don't know what else to say.
No, it's so good. Like, yeah, All Too Well, you cannot go wrong with. That one was incredible. Everyone said they loved that song. And I think that was the first time she realized, like, her fans have a lot of power and, like, what they like,
oh,
you
for
know?
Sure.
And, like,
and I think, like, just the power of the online community as well.
Yes.
Because I think, like I said, it was, I feel like, took a couple years for some people.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it was never a single. She never released a video for it. It was
yeah.
nothing. Like,
yeah.
it just kind of went very much under the radar.
Yeah. And it was unbelievable to listen to, for sure. And it's, mm-hmm. like, 5 minutes long for the original. And then when you listen to the 10-minute version for the re-released album, my God. Like, hello?
Yeah.
Like,
I was a little skeptical at first, of course, you know.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
It grew on me, and now like, I can't.
It grew on me too.
Now it's like I can't listen to the original.
I was thinking that too.
It's like,
girl, I was thinking that too.
I'm like, where you immediately start singing the
yes,
the extended now.
Yes,
that's just All Too Well. To
oh,
me
it's so
at
true.
This point, but it really is a good song.
God.
But like we were saying before, do you really think that like, cause she's had like an interview where she said like that. Oh yeah, like she was just so passionate one day. She was singing rehearsal with her band and then just all flowed out of her 10 minutes and she had to edit it down.
Yes. Yep.
To the 4-minute version.
I know exactly what
and
you're talking about. Yeah.
I don't know.
There's something about
that. I don't know
that.
If I fully believe that.
Right. And I'm like, okay.
I think she's a really good writer and I think she knows how to go back and like
yeah.
write like in the vein of that song. And like, I think she knew what she was doing. I
yeah.
think she, you know, she wrote it. An extended version very well,
mm-hmm.
but do I believe that it was
fully
it just flowed out of her without a notebook or pen
right.
in hand? She was just playing her guitar with
was
her
it
band.
Fully in 2011 or whenever
yeah,
she wrote
I don't
it
know.
You know,
I mean, maybe some of it was
yeah I mean,
but
there's like one line in it. Did the I think it's that. Yeah.
Paint you blue.
Just between us, did the love affair maim you too?
Yeah, that one. Because it's kind of like, okay, I had no idea what maim meant back then. I know. Like, did she know?
She
like,
definitely has a dictionary and thesaurus.
Oh, a million percent. All, and like, good for her.
In her recording studio.
Good for her on that. That re-recording is definitely one of my absolute favorites for sure.
She uses so many different words in this song, and she uses them well.
Yeah.
All too well.
So lame. We're so lame. Oh, my God. But no, that one's a good one. Oh, my God.
And in the cities bare and cold, I still remember the first fall of snow and how it glistened as it fell. I remember it all too well.
Now that's harmonizing.
I know, right? That was good shit. No, dude, like one of my other favorites, I will say, oh man, there's three more favorites.
Okay.
I would say. Okay.
Oh, favorite songs?
Yeah, from this album. Everything Has Changed, obviously. Mm-hmm. I'm a huge Ed Sheeran fan.
And I forgot about that song.
Yeah, and I was an Ed Sheeran fan before this album even came out. So, like, when...
Oh, yeah.
You know, this was when people were starting to realize who he was.
Back when Ed Sheeran was good.
Yeah. When he was good. You're funny. Good shit.
I don't know if you're a big fan of
Ed Sheeran. I still am.
I only like his old stuff. I feel like he's a little bit of a sellout now.
Interesting. But, you know. I can see that. Okay, I can see that where people think that. Yeah. But I don't know, man, that one is just like so raw. Like it's just fucking, you can tell it's him. Like it's just ripping on the guitar. Oh, yeah. And like, that's just a good one. That's a really good one.
The great song where two great artists come together and make a great song.
But that one is one that I will admit I cannot listen to the re-recording of because there's something wrong in there. There's like, I don't know if there's like a missing note or like a wrong note. Like, it just bothers the fuck out of me every time I hear it. So I have to listen to the original. I don't know what it is. It bothers me so much, though.
Yeah.
I can point out exactly what it is.
I know. We could, like, sit here and, like, listen.
Oh, I know.
Song by song and be like, oh, I know. Did you hear that? Did you hear that?
Oh, yeah. And we would. Definitely.
I know.
That one.
I love State of Grace.
I loved State of Grace.
The Last Time was also another
one. The Last Time was another one I wanted to talk about.
With what's it?
Gary Lightbody, bitch.
From, what was he from?
Snow Patrol. That's literally my number one band besides like Taylor and Ed.
The harmonies on that song,
so good.
I just love a good duet too, like, yeah. And same thing with obviously Everything Has Changed, but
yeah,
that song is just,
dude, that one I have cried like,
this
to
this is
so
the last
times.
Time I'm telling you this is the way that they're both just like pleading to each other is just so great.
I want to play a little bit of that one because that one, like, do. I've seen Snow Patrol live, man, 5 times, and I just, when I saw that Gary was like on this album with her, I was like, oh my god, two of my favorite people coming together. And then I saw Ed Sheeran, I was like, oh my god, there's three of them. Like, it was just so good. But here's this isn't the original, but it's just, it still gets me, you know. And it's just like, let's see if we can go towards the end. They're definitely pleading.
At the top of your list, this is the last time I'm asking you why. You break my heart, you break your own heart.
It's just so good. Like,
it's like, please, like, put me on the top of your list. Like why is it so hard for you to love me?
Right, exactly. And like, man, it's just so good. There. It is just so good. I love the original more than this one too. I mean, they're both great, but the original, there's something about it. I think it's because, you know, I remember specifically back in Ohio, like, I would just cry to that song a lot. Like, I don't know what it was, because that was, I want to say that song.
It's a very emotional song.
Yes. That one got me. This album got me. You know, it really was like, holy fuck, I like Taylor Swift.
Right. I also really like Holy Ground. It's very like fast paced. It feels, to me, that feels like, okay, I'm feeling a lot of feelings and I'm living in New York City.
Yes.
You know what I mean? It's just like very I was reminiscing just the other day. I remember. But
having
coffee all alone, Lord, it took me away. New York Times, I'm keeping my horns like a perfect rhyme. It's fun.
Yeah, like no, that one. That one's definitely a good one. Man,
do you have any least favorite songs from that?
Honestly, fuck. The lucky one, maybe.
Yeah. I didn't really like The Moment I Knew. I think that was
you don't like The Moment I Knew? Oh my God.
I mean,
girl, that one
came to me later. It's not that I don't like it, it's just my least.
That's interesting. I want to say that one grew on me. I feel like I never paid attention to it until recently, and I fucking love it.
This is what I wrote in my notes. I said it's too obvious. Feels like a song someone would write trying to sound like Taylor.
Ah. Okay, that's funny.
I'm like, if that makes sense.
I'm obsessed with the storytelling in that one.
Yeah,
like she's literally talking about like how, okay, she knew that this relationship allegedly with Jake was over because he didn't show up to her fucking 21st birthday. Mm-hmm. You know, like that was the moment she knew.
I
like,
think
it was over.
I think for me it was just kind of like, okay, we already have somebody, we know what happened, girl. We don't need another song.
I loved that one. I fucking love I get that it. One. That's so funny.
But no, I mean, I didn't really have that many, like, there's no songs that I hated on that album. Because, really? Again, this was, like, for the, I think, probably my favorite era.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. How about I Almost Do? Because I fucking love that one. Oh,
I just want to tell you.
Yeah.
Takes everything in me not to call you.
Oh, it's so good. Oh, it's so good.
Yeah.
Treacherous is one of my favorite long ones like that. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not even long compared
to some
of these.
They're all kind of slow in this, they're just slow on this album. Yeah. But, and I think that's why she had to have a couple upbeat ones for her singles. And that that's why sense. They sound so different.
Yeah. Yeah.
But
But
I like it. I that was like, finally, I was like, okay, she's an artist. She's a singer-songwriter. This is what she does well.
Yep. I do like.
I'm trying to remember. Was she nominated for? I think she was nominated for a Grammy for this album, right?
She was, and then
she lost.
Yeah, she lost to Daft Punk. Yeah,
which this also, I felt like that kind of put in motion a lot of things for her career, because I felt like if you watch like her documentary, she talks a lot about like, oh my God, like I really thought like that was it. That was my moment. I was going to win a Grammy. Yep. And then when she lost, she kind of like flipped out.
Random of access memories. Yeah, I remember that.
And. Which is a shame, because to me, this is like one of her best albums.
So
and,
good.
But she felt the need to go more pop. She was like, oh, okay. Like, well, they didn't like that. Then I better do something different. And it's like, and I think for a while I was a little bit resentful of her pop music, because I was such a big fan of Red. And then she was like, I'm like, girl, you don't need to like sell yourself out to like, you know, be liked and be popular. You don't need to win a Grammy.
Yeah. No.
Just to, you know,
and
be considered good.
Yeah.
Same but, with, but it did set a lot of things in motion for her. And then, cause what came out after that? What's her next album?
1989, I believe.
Oh yeah.
But dude, that also happened with Reputation. She didn't win a Grammy, and it was like, bitch, like that. We'll get there.
Yeah.
I'm so bitter.
I think it is crazy to me that she finally won a Grammy for 1989 out of all her albums.
Yeah.
I mean, I like 1989, but it is interesting, because I'm like, if anything, you'd think she would have won for Red.
Yeah. No, yeah. I'm curious, does she win any for Red? Like, did 22 get anything? I don't know. I'd have to look that up again.
I don't know.
But dude, there's one song on the deluxe version of Red, Girl at Home. I love the original, hate the re-recording.
Okay, this is where I think we've spoken about this before.
Really?
I actually feel the opposite.
Really? Okay. Yes.
I think I kind of like, I don't know. I felt like the original was a little, I don't know. I just didn't really like the sound of it. And I felt like what she did was so vastly different. So I do get it, because I feel like if I was a fan of the original, I would have been like, what the fuck is this?
Yeah, yeah.
But because I didn't like the original, I was like, oh, okay. No, I kind of like what you did there.
For context. You can tell immediately.
So different.
So different. Let's play a little bit of the original. It's just fucking iconic, in my opinion. Don't look at me. You got a girl at home, and everybody knows that. Everybody knows that. Don't look at me. You got a girl at home, and everybody knows that. And then you go to a re-recorded. Like, are you a Martian? Are we on
very
Venus?
Like, she adds a lot of production to
this. Yes, I don't
re-record.
Like that. Maybe I'm wondering like how many things that she like, is like kind of like, oh, I'm so glad I can change that now or whatever, you know? And like maybe she hated that song and that's why it was deluxe version already, you know?
I think so. And then I think like, that's exactly the case with that song.
But I fucking loved the original. I can see how it can be a little demo-y.
It was a little demo-y, you know, the first one.
Yeah.
But yeah, but I think for sure if I was a, if I had liked the original in the way that I think other people do.
Yeah.
I would have been pissed.
I would have been pissed. No, but it's true though. Yeah, that one, girl. That one, I love the story of that one too, because she's like, you know, I've been that girl before, so I'm gonna be respectful and tell you no, and like, you know, why do you?
It
have
is.
Your phone?
I know lyrically, it's an interesting song.
Yeah. No. Yeah. It's like, why'd you turn your phone off?
Everyone knows. Yeah.
Everyone knows that, you have a girlfriend.
Do you have thoughts about like? Who you think that song is about?
No.
Because really every time I listen to it, I'm kind of like, who's she talking about? Because it kind of sounds like it could be about probably maybe another famous person.
Yeah, I can feel
that. That was like because the way obviously she's talking about everyone knows that you have a girl at home. Right. So to me, it's a celebrity.
Yeah. Yeah.
Who
is
known for having a girlfriend.
Yeah.
And or a wife, like, who knows?
And he's hitting on her like crazy. Yeah.
And he's sitting there hitting on her.
Ooh, I want to know.
First thing that came to mind is Leonardo DiCaprio.
Oh my god, was she under 25?
Maybe back then, maybe.
Yeah, she was 22. But no, dude, going to the vault tracks of Red, bitch, some very good ones. Obviously, All Too Well 10-minute version can't surpass that. Unbelievable,
best one for sure.
Definitely best one. Behind that,
I bet you think about me.
I was gonna say that, girl.
Love.
I bet you think about me. Yeah, I bet you think about me.
I love that video too.
The video is so good.
Miles Teller, I love him.
I think Blake Lively directed that. No,
she did.
Yeah,
she did.
Yeah, they're good friends. That's such a good song. But that's
it's a fun one because I feel like we've all had that moment where you think about like an ex.
Yep.
You know, whether it be a situationship or a relationship where you're just like, I bet you think about me.
Yeah, I know. You probably hear my name all the time, honey. Yeah. And well, look what you did. Yep.
You lost a good one, honey.
Yep. And that one everyone thinks is about Jake Gyllenhaal. That's where I think that's the Kitchen Table Bills one you were referencing earlier.
Mm-hmm.
And how he has his fucking like.
You
vegan
grew up in
shoes.
Beverly Hills.
Yeah, I grew up in Beverly Hills and your million-dollar couch.
My favorite line. Favorite line. I love that lyric.
I love
so
that.
Fucking million-dollar couch.
Yes.
Because that's like the end bridge. That's really
yes.
fun.
Yes, I bet you
I
think
to,
about me.
I want to look at the lyrics.
Yes.
I bet you think about me. She always, like, one thing I love about Taylor is, like, she's known for the bridge, the famous, like, the
she's good. Known for that, yeah.
Angsty bridge that you can just like belt. Was none of that shit mattered.
Then I was too late. I think it's. Oh, hit.
Need music concert every week. With your organic shoes and your million-dollar couch. It's so good.
It's so good.
The organic
dude.
Shoes too. It's like, oh my
right.
god, because it's like calling.
Yes.
So calling him out to be like, oh, you think
you're so much better than me.
You think you're a good person because you buy organic shoes and you're like so hippie.
Right. And you
but you have a fucking $1 million couch, motherfucker.
Right.
Fuck
right.
off.
And also she's mentioned the whole indie record thing and we're going back to the 10-minute version of All Too Well now. Because she mentions in the normal version and this one, like the red scarf, and everyone knows. Yeah, everyone knows. And she actually did confirm it in an interview that is a metaphor.
Mm-hmm.
So do we think that it's her virginity?
I mean, I think that's what she's trying to tell us.
Yeah.
I find it interesting and I find it almost like kind of hard to believe because I didn't think that with her.
Yeah.
But I don't know, because I'm like, do you really think that she waited that long?
That's what I'm wondering too, because there was how many different boyfriends that she fucking, you know, dated beforehand, and it's like, did she wait for him?
That's what I said. What about John Mayer? I've had this debate with my sister quite a bit, and she's like, really? Well, obviously this is what she's trying to tell us,
right? Yeah,
but
I don't know. I honestly really thought for the longest time it was an actual red scarf. I didn't think it was like,
well, yeah,
rep, you know, I was like thinking like, damn, like, does Maggie really still have the red scarf?
I know. You know what's funny? Is I think like Andy Cohen asked Maggie Gyllenhaal on his show.
Did he really?
I think he did.
I love that.
She was just like, girl, I don't know.
Oh, I think I saw that. I think I did see that. That's pretty funny.
I know.
But also, did she lose her virginity in Maggie Gyllenhaal's house?
I mean, shit, maybe. That's interesting. But I don't know. I just find it so hard to believe because she has so much music about ex-boyfriends before this.
Right.
Like, you know, Taylor Lautner, John Mayer. I'm like,
yeah.
I feel like she fucked John Mayer.
I feel like she fucked John Mayer too, especially how mad she was at him. You know?
There's
and
no
like
way.
Saying how creepy
Dear
he
John,
was.
You telling me like, she wrote Dear John without fucking him?
Right. Very very I mean, surprised by
that's
that.
That's what like, I'm saying. So I'm like, I think she's just maybe trying to like make people think like, oh no, I'm so innocent. Maybe it's just like maybe like good PR. Like she's just trying to like do PR cleanup to make it seem like, no, I'm not, I didn't sleep with any of these people.
Right, right, right. We're like, we went to third base.
Right,
y'all.
Like I didn't sleep with all of them. Like but like no, there's no way you wrote Dear John.
Right. I mean, I lost my virginity at 19, and that was when allegedly she was dating John Mayer. I'm not saying we're the same. But I mean, there are some vault tracks that I mean, better man, whatever. Nothing new is whatever. I love Phoebe Bridgers, but I don't know. There's something about those two. I'm just like, whatevs. Oh, dude, Message in a Bottle? Like, that one
I do like the Nothing New song.
You do like the Nothing New? Yeah. Dude, Message in a Bottle, like, actually made its rounds, like, on, like, top 40
I actually don't even
shit.
Remember what that sounds like.
Really? It's super poppy, dude. Like, super poppy. Like, and I think it's a little too poppy. Like, it's not really Taylor. You know what I mean?
I know. I'm, like, looking at these. I'm like, what do they sound like? Fuck.
I feel like she didn't want to write that. Or she wanted to write it for someone else, maybe.
I think
for the
did.
Radio.
I literally think it, I feel like it sounds like a Target commercial to me. I feel like it might have actually been played in a Target commercial.
Like it might have been. Like that sounds
but that's
not
what
right.
That's what it sounds like to me.
Yeah. I can totally see
it
that.
It just sounds like phoned in a little bit.
Yeah. Yeah. There's something about it that I'm just like, okay.
Or like a soundtrack.
Not,
like, I don't know. Like
you know.
A movie soundtrack.
Song? Now that I'm looking at the writer's bitch, it's literally Max Martin and Shellback. This makes so much sense. That makes so much sense. Okay. Yeah. Well, we see you, girl.
Yeah.
But there are some that I've never even paid attention to.
That might have been like when she first started working with them.
Maybe.
Do you think?
That,
I don't know if
yeah,
you've
because
been looking
that was,
at it.
Yeah,
I feel like
she was,
Red was probably when she first started.
That was that sounds about right because
like,
she had.
I can work with the big wigs. Now.
Right. Because she was with 1989 the whole time with them, I'm pretty sure. Mm-hmm. So that makes sense.
That was probably like her.
Yeah.
Her start.
Yeah. My absolute favorite. I just said that like four times. Not my absolute favorite, but definitely one of my favorites is Babe. Only because they did that. She did that song with it wasn't the Dixie Chicks. Who did she do that song
Sugar
with?
Sugar
something, thank
right?
you.
Sugar, what are they,
Sugarland?
Sugarland.
Yes. I love that the wine's hitting. I'm like, Sugar.
I'm like, Sugar something.
No, she did that. Girl, that song is so fucking good
babe,
with Sugarland.
Babe, how could you do this, babe?
Oh, it's so good. We're totally playing a little bit of that. Oh, my God.
I can hear,
God.
Like, it sounds like their song.
It does. It does. And, like, I feel like she just kind of threw it on
like
the album.
Like a cover. Because it is a cover, right?
Is it?
Or did she give it to them? I don't know.
Maybe.
I can't remember now.
It's so good.
Because I swore that they had their own single version, right?
Maybe.
I'm here on the kitchen floor. You call, but I won't hear it. You said no one else. How could you do this, babe?
And it's just Taylor in the background.
You really do this, babe.
Let's get to it.
What a shame.
Oh, wait.
Didn't want to be the one that got away.
She's only in the bridge, I think.
How could you do I'm here on the kitchen floor. You called it, I won't hear it. You said no one else.
But then it's when it's just her.
I think, yeah.
Yeah,
I don't know, man. See, no, I think Sugarland, it was their song and Taylor wrote it. So I think Sugarland, it was like their song first.
Got it.
So then on the vault tracks, she was like, well, let's re-record it.
Yes. It's a good fucking song.
Because I was like, I'm pretty sure it was like their single.
That makes
sense. But I think it was just like a song. Like, this was like the first time that Taylor was like, I'm actually going to give one of my songs away.
I love that.
No. To another artist.
That is such a good fucking song. I'm not going to lie. Like, that one, I can sing all the time. I do love that one.
Under the Radar song that my Apple Music keeps shuffling for me is Forever Winter.
Really?
And slowly starting to become not a favorite, but I'm starting to like it more because it's one of those songs I never really listened to.
Yeah, I do not know that one. And even though I love Ed Sheeran, I've never really listened to Run too much.
So. No, me neither.
Yeah. The very first night, couldn't tell you what one is.
Me neither.
I know. Like, love you, Tay, but there's some I just kind of skip. There are some skips. Like, I'm sorry.
I know. Like, I think, like, with the re-records, a lot of them I just, like, listen to it, like, for like a week straight.
Yeah. Oh, me.
And girl. Then I don't really go back to them.
Is it my ADHD or my OCD?
Well, I think a lot of times for me, when I listen to Taylor, I just shuffle her songs and they just never pop up.
Ah.
You know?
But here's another thing is like Spotify shuffling is not actually shuffling. It definitely goes off of like your favorite ones that you listen to a lot. And I'm like, okay, this is not a real shuffle, bitch. This is not how this is supposed to work.
I know.
Ugh, so annoying. But yeah, Red, amazing album. Good shit. Great re-records. Big fan of All Too Well 10-minute version. Thank you, Jesus. Fuck. But man, let's go to album 5. Yeah,
let's move on from Red.
Girl, it's hard to move on from Red because we love Red. I know. I mean, this one, man. Album 5, 1989, baby. 2014.
This is fuck. Pop Princess Taylor.
Pop
Girl
Princess.
Girl Squad Taylor. Fuck Men Taylor. Yep.
This is when she officially was full-blown pop and everyone was like, okay, we're accepting this now.
Mm-hmm. She said, I'm doing it. Yep. She said, okay, I didn't win a Grammy. Well, here we go.
Yep, yep. Unbelievable. Here we go.
She said, Jack Antonoff, here we go.
Yep, Jack Antonoff.
This enter Jack Antonoff.
Jack Antonoff, we love you. Oh,
this
my
is
God.
When he this is when he entered the picture and he did not leave.
No,
he has not left.
He has not left. He is great. If I ran into him, I would have a very awkward conversation with him and be like, "You're awesome," and he'd be like, "Thanks." I
know. I find it wild because my second favorite artist is Lana Del Rey, and like he love produces that. Both of their music.
God, A&W girl, I can't believe it's Grammy nominated.
I find
thank
it
God.
Interesting though because I'm not like the biggest fan of Bleachers, but I don't. Yeah. It's not that I dislike him. I just have never gotten like too into them. But
yeah.
He's a great producer.
Oh, he's so good.
He knows how to.
He knows.
He knows how to produce these female icons.
Yeah,
music.
Bitch. Yeah. Good guy. Good shit.
But,
man.
Okay, so do you want to start with your favorite?
Yes. Okay, so I will say 1989. It was 2014 when it came out. I started listening to it in, like, 2015. And I was, like, just starting, like, my news reporting gig. And, like, I had another Swiftie that was, like, a producer working with me. And she and I, like, would talk about it. And I think I really want to say, like, that's when I started to love Taylor. Like, I liked Taylor in Red. Loved Taylor in 1989. And was a full-blown Swiftie from then on out. I don't know what it was about 1989. I watched that world tour in my bathtub with a bottle of wine like 5 times and my mom was like, you're doing this again? Mm-hmm. And I'm like, yes, it was so fucking good. Like, god damn, man, this album is everything. Mm-hmm. Like, my favorite though, I would say shit.
Do you want me to start?
Yeah, no, okay. No. No, yeah, start. Okay. Don't give me ideas.
Well, I think just in terms of like perfect pop song, like iconic, it would be Style.
Love Style.
That's my favorite, I think. And I think I realized it too in the Eras Tour movie, because I think when that song came on, everyone flipped out and it was like, it was just such a moment. Like, I felt like we all like really got up and we're just like, this is such a bop.
Right,
like,
when
it's
you hear
so
those guitar
fun
riffs,
to dance to.
Bro.
It's so good. It's like, yes, you got that James Dean look in your eye.
Yes. And I got that red lip classic thing that you like, girl. I know.
It's just so good. It's just so good. It's just like, to me, like a little, it's just a perfect
and
pop
we
song.
All know who that's about. Obviously. We all know. His name is in the title.
Mr. Harry Styles.
Harry Styles. He looks like James Dean with that hair.
I know. And he's such, I love him too. And
yeah.
He's one of my faves as well. So I won't talk anything bad on him. No shiz on him. But. She
ripped him to shreds.
And I will say, as far as the Taylor's version goes,
yes,
I think 1989 has the best.
I'm so glad you agree.
Vault song.
So fucking good. I'm obsessed with every single one of them.
I do think, like, as far as for vault songs, yes, for re-records,
okay.
Because
yeah.
What are some of the songs?
I honestly kind of disagree. I feel like I love the re-recordings on 1989 compared to the other ones. I don't know what it is.
Out of the Woods sounded completely different to me.
Ooh, I could tell the difference in the production for sure. Yeah.
Like I Know Places.
Yes. I Know Places.
New Romantics. I die. It was so bad.
Oh. Really?
It was so bad.
Because the original is incredible.
And just it's kind of like with the song, like, The Girl at Home. That's how, okay, yeah. That's how it felt to me.
Yeah, okay.
It was just like the production was completely different.
Huh.
And I wonder if it's because New Romantics was also like a bonus track.
Yes. Which is such a shame.
And it's become obviously like a fan favorite.
And it like led her, I'm pretty sure she started the 1989 tour with New Romantics. Like, dead serious, New Romantics is probably my number one. And I know you asked me earlier that I want to say that's my number one.
Yeah.
And it was a fucking deluxe version bonus track. Yeah.
Something I also was going to say about style, too, is that I feel like I love that, like, for the first time, I feel like she kind of stops playing victim a little bit in her songs. I feel like she's finally like, oh, like one of her lyrics is, I've been there a few times.
Yes.
Like, she's fine. Like, it's kind of like, I mean, yeah, you've done bad things, but so have I.
Yes, I
and
see that.
She's
okay.
Like, I feel like it's also the first album in general where she's kind of like finally diving into her sexuality just a little.
Yeah.
She's teasing with it a little bit more. Yeah. Whereas, like, coming from Red, it was such
I'm an innocent girl.
I'm a victim a little bit. Like, these bad things have happened to me. Not that it's a bad thing, but just that, like, my heart has been broken in Red.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
these things happen to me. Whereas, like, in 1989, it's like, well, okay, I've gained a little confidence. I know
yes.
how to, I can do it too. I can get back at you too.
Yeah.
And, like, she's finally like, well, you know, let's play this game now.
I love this.
And you see that in Blank Space as well.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, definitely. I love when she explained what Blank Space was about. She pretty much was like trying to get back at the media for mm-hmm. trying to paint her as this like crazy bitch, you know, that always.
Yeah. And it's very subtle too.
Yeah.
It's just like,
yes,
it's not like, Reputation, like, really just like, bitch. It's just like, yes, okay, I'm going like hard with it. Whereas, like, I feel like 1989 is very like subtle and the innuendos,
yes,
and the sexuality and all of that. So
I do love how she was literally born December 13th, 1989. She barely made it into 1989 as a, you know, she was almost a 90s baby.
Mm-hmm.
And she like really honed in on like the 80s, you know, synth pop and that sort of style for this album. And I think I love it. Like, mm-hmm, I love 1989 and what it embodied and mm-hmm how she really stuck with the theme. And that is why she won like album of the year for this.
Right. I also love some of her slower songs, like You Are In Love.
I love You Are In Love. Great one.
That was also one of my surprise songs.
Do you know who that one's about?
Yeah.
You know who that one's about?
Lena Dunham.
Yeah.
And Jack Antonoff.
She wrote that about her producer. I know they're not together anymore, but that's okay, because, I mean, it's still embodied, like the burnt toast on Sundays.
I love that. It's like, you can hear it in the silence.
You can hear it in the silence. Silence.
Ooh, you can feel it on the way home.
Way home. Ooh. I could go on.
I know.
Love that one. But I do love how this album was like a super New York album. Like, I love New York myself. And so this one, she was really mm-hmm trying to hone in, like, with the Welcome to New York, especially that was, you know, the first track. Shake It Off in general. Like, come on. Like, that one, you could tell, was going to be the lead single. You could tell.
Clearly, yeah. Like, it's definitely, Everyone sounds like a single, you know?
Yeah. Oh, for sure.
But it's fun. I love to dance to that song or like work out to that song. It's just like, it's just, you know.
I think that song might have surpassed Love Story in terms of like popularity.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I think so. Like everyone plays Shake It Off, you know? Mm-hmm. But in terms of like my absolute favorites, bitch, like Clean with Imogen Heap, mm-hmm. like her vocals, incredible. I want to say Clean and I Know Places are behind. Those are absolutely my faves behind like New Romantics, mm-hmm. you know. Those ones are so underrated.
I Know Places.
Oh my God. And the creepiness of the production is mm-hmm. perfect. It's fucking perfect.
Like, and it's like so, it's interesting. It's an interesting song because I feel like she's like, it feels like a kind of seductive game. And then when you actually pay attention to the lyrics, it's she's like basically saying like,
I'm fucking terrified.
We're terrified and I have to sneak around with you.
Right. Like, because
I can't do anything normal.
The fucking paparazzi is creeping, man. Like everybody's creeping. Like,
but it's done, the production and the song is just, it's done in such a way that it sounds fun.
Yeah. No. Oh, for sure.
And then you listen to her, you're like, and you pay attention to what she's actually trying to say. You're like, oh.
Yeah. Yeah. I do love How You Get the Girl, just because I loved her outfit during the tour and how it was like a light up pink like two piece that she was wearing, and it was really, really fun and it was really cute, and I was just like, oh,
see, that's another song that just sounds like a Target commercial.
Really?
I think again, maybe it was.
It might have been
promoting the Target version of the
album. It definitely might have been. Definitely. I will say I know Out of the Woods is one of the ones where mm-hmm. She was given the like production and she did the vocals to that rather than the other way around. Hmm. I know, right?
That's fun.
And then there's like some videos of her like purposefully like making like certain sounds to like record. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of cool. I loved that part.
Another one about Harry for sure.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Because that's when the whole like. Is that the song where she talks about the accident?
Yes, the little snowmobile accident or whatever. Yep. 20 stitches in the hospital room. You started crying, baby. I did too. Yep. Yeah.
The song came up. I was looking at you.
Yep. That one is Out of the Woods.
It's funny too, because I feel like most of her songs about Harry sound very like, just like, I don't know, nothing bad.
Yeah.
None of the songs about Harry in the album sound that bad. And then the vault tracks.
The vault tracks.
Are, she goes in.
The vault tracks, girl. So
it's such a contrast.
Oh my God. But these vault tracks, girl, like you were saying, like complete opposite of painting mm-hmm. like Harry Styles in a good light.
Sly, I find so funny because it's just like, I feel like she's just basically saying like, you're so hot, I don't give a fuck. Like, they can call me a slut. It might be worth it for once.
Yeah, yeah. Like,
do it.
Yeah.
I don't care because, like, I'm so into you and I think you're so hot that I do not care that I'm being called a slut right now.
Which, I love that.
Girl, good for you. That's how into Harry Styles she was.
Yeah.
Like, I know. You had mixed feelings about that song,
He's though. Cute. I did have mixed feelings. I love that we were texting about it, too, the second it came out. I love Alexa so much. I literally was like, girl, I want to know your thoughts. But no, dude, like, Slut, like, I think everybody thought was going to be, like, an anthem, like, an upbeat, mm-hmm. like, super maybe angry because there's an exclamation point in the title, too, you know? Mm-hmm. But, dude, it was, like, a very, like,
but
melancholy.
I like it. It's, like, very, like, sensual to me. I feel like she's kind of just being, like, she's giving into the slut persona. She's like, yeah, like it's worth it because
if you call me a slut, yeah, it's just even the way she says slut. Yeah, like,
and
I don't
if
know.
I'm gonna be drunk, I might as well be drunk in love.
I don't know, man. There's something about that song. I'm just kind of like,
saying, send the code.
Yeah. Oh,
send the
yeah.
code, I'll be waiting. Like, she's just into it.
Hey.
It's just.
That's okay.
Like,
yeah.
She said, I'll pay the price, but you won't.
Right. That
Again,
is true.
Again, I'll just, like.
Yeah. Guys never get that, you know, sort of downfall.
Everyone wants him. That was my crime. The wrong place at the right time. Breakdown and he's pulling me in a world of boys, he's a gentleman.
Yeah,
I love that line too.
Me too. Like, I do like that one.
She's like, oh
Yeah.
He's a gentleman. Yeah. Which I think he probably was, but then he fucked her over.
Yeah. So. Like, I'm kind of curious. Like, yeah.
I think he is a gentleman, but I can see that he probably was just a player at the same time.
Oh, yeah.
If that makes any sense. Like,
man, they were probably young. He was
also a gentleman.
Yeah. He was young.
But then the rest of the song, Say Don't Go.
Girl, Say Don't Go is so good. She's like,
literally just saying, like, he refuses. She's saying, I'm in love with him and he won't tell me that he loves me.
Can we just talk about how Diane Warren is a fucking co-writer on that song?
Wait, really?
Yeah. Isn't that wild?
On Say Don't Go?
Say Don't Go. Diane Warren and Taylor Swift. Isn't that insane?
Huh.
I know, right? Interesting. That song is, I would say, my second favorite out of those vault tracks. Say Don't Go, like,
I actually don't listen to it as much.
Oh, really?
I don't know why. Not that I really, I don't know. I listen to Slut. I listen to it, Is It Over Now? And then I listen to Now That We Don't Talk.
Yeah.
I don't know.
But not, dude, now that we don't talk, though, like, that one is straight to the point.
I
don't
have
to
pretend I like acid rock.
I love that. Fucking
love that lyric. That's hilarious. So much.
That is really funny. She literally was pretty much saying, like, my mom said that, you know, this is for the best.
Yeah.
You know? Yep. And I love,
like,
that one.
Just being like, I'm glad I don't have to, like, pretend to like things for you.
Right. I love that. We all do it in every relationship. Yeah. Like,
and also calling him out for being, like, a bougie fucker on yachts.
Yes.
And obviously the infamous photo of her, like, leaving the island on a yacht.
Yep.
That and they were on. Yeah. And that's when they broke up.
That's when she broke.
The
right.
blue dress.
She was in she was in the blue dress. And everybody knows, like, she got broken up with. Yep. But that's also one of her absolute shortest songs too. It's only 2 minutes 26 seconds, and that's like the shortest song she's ever released, and people are like, whoa, I wonder what that. I mean, like, hey, straight to the point, bitch. Like, Now That We Don't Talk, I can admit all this shit. In my ex relationship, I pretended to like soccer and Liverpool and all that. Just to, I mean, not really pretended, but more so like supported. No, I mean,
you get into it, right?
And it's kind of like, okay, like, now I don't have to give a fuck anymore.
Like, and also just knowing it's about Harry Styles
makes sense.
Hilarious to me.
Totally makes sense. Yeah, but the next one, Suburban Legends.
Yeah, it's a for me too.
It's an
it's another. It's like a storyteller song.
I do,
and
like,
I don't
that.
Know what the fuck she's talking about.
I think I feel like she's talking about
the,
like,
school gymnasium.
Yes,
I don't understand.
It
throws me off a little bit.
That's the part that really sticks out in my mind. I think she's getting in her mind of like, I'm gonna bring you back home to like a school reunion, and like, it's we were meant to be better than our hometowns and stuff like that. Like, I'm wondering if she's talking about someone she went to school with, and that's, she thought maybe that
that's
was gonna happen.
That's what I thought
with.
At first, but then I'm like, I think it's just another song about Harry. I think that she's saying that we're both, I mean, at the time he was in One Direction.
Yeah.
And I think she's saying like, we're both meant to just be suburban legends. Like, we're both.
Yeah.
Like, meant for like big lives, and maybe we're not meant to be together, but that we're both, like, she's clearly talking about saying like, we're both famous, and we're both gonna be like legendary,
we're gonna be the coolest ones at the reunion. We have to discuss though, Is It Over Now? Because that is my number one vault track from 1989, hands down, and everybody's. I really think she thought Slut was gonna be that banger, the one that everybody wants, the one that's gonna be on the radio. No, bitch. Is It Over Now is everybody's favorite, and that one hit home for sure. I love
song. Like, the little, did you learn the TikTok dance?
No, I'm not a TikToker. I mean, like, I should be,
I did learn it because it was an easy one.
Okay. Oh wait, and then you like jump into the, is it for the bridge?
Yeah.
Or maybe, is it the bridge? Think I didn't see you, there were flashing lights. At least I had the decency to keep my nights out of sight.
Flashing lights, at least I had the decency to keep my nights out of sight.
Only rumors by my hips and thighs and my whispering sighs. Oh, Lord, I think about jumping.
Oh, it's the mic. Whoops. But yeah, no, it was fun. It's another classic Taylor bridge that's fun to just.
But it's also like, holy shit, that was quick. Like, she barely breathes in that bridge. And it's kind of like, that was a little hard for me to learn because I'm just like, damn, bitch, like, fuck.
I love it because it's like, I love the kind of discography of these vault tracks because it's like, the first one was Slut. It's like, she's saying, like, I don't give a fuck. I like you. I'm into you.
Yeah.
I'm all in. And then it's like, please say you don't go. It's like, please tell me you love me. And then yes. you won't tell me.
Yeah.
And then it's like, now that we don't talk, it's like grieving.
Yep.
Suburban Legends. And then it's like, is it over now? She's like saying like, well, like fuck you. Like,
yeah.
Why are you like going out and like dating? Like you're, yep. you're being very public about like who you're dating now.
Yeah. Oh, and dating the exact same type of people too.
Now like, you're pissing me off. Is yes. like what she's saying.
Yep, yep. I love how she's also like, well, you know, was it over when you slept with this model? Well, was it over when I actually, you know,
like I feel like these vault tracks could just be its own EP.
I can see that. Yeah.
Like it's just like going through the motions of a breakup.
Yeah. Fucking bomb. Love that one. And of course, Bad Blood with Kendrick Lamar. You cannot go wrong. I love Kendrick Lamar. I think I listened to that one more than the original. Because everybody loves that. Like, you forgive, you forget, but you never let it go. Everybody loves that. We all say that during the tour and shit. And
right.
Yeah. Sweeter Than Fiction. It was one that was kind of released on like the Tangerine edition, like for like Target or something, I think. I think that's for a movie, right? Mm-hmm. And I don't pay attention to that song.
Yeah, it feels like a, yeah.
Yeah. Don't know much about that one. But that's okay.
Yeah.
Because there's some other good ones, bitch. Mm-hmm. But moving on.
Yeah, the transition from 1989 to.
Yes. The Reputation.
This was like a moment in time because she dropped off. Like, I felt like she. This is like when she was so famous during the 1989 Bad Blood Girl Squad.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
era. Yep. And then shit went down with yes. Kanye and Kim.
Yep.
And I think people just started hating her because
yep.
she was just too much in everybody's faces. Like people, I think, saw too much of her.
Yeah.
So I feel that's.
She became a threat to people.
In between the two albums, she kind of went into hiding.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I would too. Like, but the thing is.
People just started hating her.
Yeah. People like.
This was the moment.
Yeah.
In between these two albums, that was the moment everyone started hating
yeah.
her.
Yeah. This was when Bleachella happened, everyone calls it, when she like bleached her hair. Everybody knows when you like bleach your hair, dye your hair or something like that, like you're kind of going through some shit.
Yeah.
Everyone knows that. But this is when that happened. She went to the Met Gala. She
cheated on Calvin Harris yes. with Tom Hiddleston.
Yeah, a little wild. We all which,
love
know.
Girl love.
We love we to support. See it because like in this
we love
album,
a problematic queen.
Yeah, she's a little problematic for
she
sure.
Cut her hair short, she bleached it. She was and like, she said, "I don't know what I'm doing." I think she was just dating. Okay, like let's be icons together. Yes. But I think Calvin Harris was a douchebag.
Oh, yeah. Especially because
I don't think he gave a shit about her.
No, not at all.
And obviously you can hear it in a lot of her songs.
Yes.
Where she's like, I don't think you even knew who I was.
Right. And she's all like, I think he's in the club doing God knows what.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. You could tell shit went down before this album for sure. I mean, it was all over the news.
And then Tom Hiddleston with his British accent, he danced with her.
At Met Gala.
And she said, I don't give a fuck. She said, I don't know where my boyfriend is. I don't care.
Yeah. She's like, okay, let's see what happens with this. That was the shortest
relationship. It's
funny because
she touches on the cheating so lightly.
Oh, yeah.
So lightly.
Very lightly. I mean, it comes
obviously
later on.
She doesn't go into it really in Midnights with the whole April 9th thing.
Oh, yeah. But it's like, it's insane the difference between Reputation and all the other
albums.
But
I think it's interesting to note though that during that time I don't think even her fans or all of us now we know all this information, but I think when Reputation came out I don't think we fully understood what was happening.
No, not at all.
I don't think any of us maybe we kind of knew, but I don't know if any of us wanted to admit that's what happened.
Because
we saw her as such this like precious angel that would never do anything like that. We're like, she wouldn't cheat. There's no way.
Right. There's no way.
They're like, no, she's just dancing. She's having a good time. And then all of a sudden she's like, you know, in with Rhode Island in her mansions with a iHeart.
It's
like, okay, so she's dating him. This is what happened.
But it
definitely, I felt like no one really wanted to like totally say the words cheater.
Yeah. I'm just so grateful that she didn't like go off the deep end completely like a lot of people do when they get famous and go through shit. Like she clearly has a great support system and her parents or whoever her friends were at the time, because like just dyeing your hair and maybe cheating on somebody, like, that is pretty minimal compared to what could have happened, you know?
Also, another thing that was circulating at the time was people saying that Tom Hiddleston was a beard. Do you remember all that?
He was a beard? As in, like, a gay guy or something?
You don't remember all that?
No.
What?
I don't.
Everyone was saying that he was gay and that she was gay. Do you remember the whole Carly Claus thing?
I do remember that. Yeah. She was dating Carly because and all that shit.
Because there's some pictures that came out it looked like they were kissing, but I think they were just fucked up. And, like, they were at, I think, ironically, a 1975 concert.
Dead.
Her and Carly Claus, and it kind of looked like they were, like, leaning into each other, kissing.
Interesting. Okay.
And that was around that time.
And who hasn't kissed
And
a
then
girl?
Right after, she's dating she's dating Tom Hiddleston. But it's I think the reason a lot of, like, one of my best friends is gay, and she's, like, such a gayler person, so she told me
gayler.
There's, if you go on That's TikTok amazing. There's a whole thing
gayler.
The lesbians really think that Taylor is gay.
I love that.
They full-heartedly believe it. They full-heartedly believe that Taylor dated Carly Claus.
Ugh.
And that Tom Hiddleston was a beard, and that all these people, Travis Kelce is a beard, all of them are beards. They all believe it so full. It's crazy to me. It's so funny. And I just always have to be like, sure, girl, sure.
All these theories.
I'm like, you really think she's gay? Okay.
Like, whatever, dude. I mean, she might have had her fun. But who knows, maybe. Yeah.
I think, for some reason, I think a lot of people thought Tom Hiddleston was gay. I think he gives gay vibes to some people, and so everyone was like, I think because it was so, that relationship felt very forced, and the whole I heart TS shirt, it felt like a fake relationship.
For the paparazzi.
I think people thought it felt very fake, and so people were like, what is happening here?
And for how quickly that relationship went, it was very quick. So, I mean, yeah, it was clearly a rebound.
I think no one knew what the hell was going on.
No,
that time.
No, yeah, we're all
like,
holy
shit. What is happening right now? She's got her hair. She's doing this. She's doing that.
Yep.
There's a lot of photos.
Yep.
Why is she so public with this right now?
Right.
It's just, it was all very strange.
Mind you, just to give a little context, Kim Kardashian and Kanye West in 2016, maybe? It was, I want to say 2016, 2015. Definitely 2016. Like, purposefully recorded Taylor on the phone with Kanye, and he was trying to get permission to say, like, this, I made this bitch famous or something like that, but, like, cut out specific parts of the conversation and, like, edited it and, like, made it look like
bingo recording of a phone call.
right very, like, Kim needs to apologize. She never apologized for what she's done. Like, she posted it to the internet trying to take Taylor down, and it's like, listen, like, this guy never actually got full permission to say those words.
I know. I wonder what she thinks about the whole situation now that she's divorced.
Right. Now that she's not with his crazy ass. Yeah. I don't know.
Because obviously, I don't know if you watch the Kardashians, but she's very much like, she knows that Kanye is off the deep end.
Yeah.
And
She's trying to protect her kids, really. Yeah.
I think she knows.
Yeah.
And I...
Sorry.
That was a...
Yeah.
That was a burp. Yep. I would be curious to like, be, like, a fly on the wall and, like, that kind of conversation of, like, what does she actually think now?
Yeah. No, I agree. I mean, like, because we've seen her posts of her wearing, like, a purple dress that looks very reminiscent of, like, the Speak Now purple dress, and she posted, like, Taylor Swift Speak Now, like, shit. Mm-hmm. And everyone's like, whoa,
I,
like,
what's
going on?
I think she's probably scared
here of
just, like, maybe just, like, what her lawyers, like, maybe, like, just in terms of, like, getting sued maybe by Taylor, because Taylor is very adamant about saying it's an illegal phone call,
especially in the state of California.
So,
type shit.
So I think she's probably just very cautious of how she goes about it.
Damn.
But at the time, I think she was just defending her man.
Bitch, in the music video. Oh my God. Like, naked mannequin of Taylor Swift.
Oh my God, I know.
I totally forgot about that. But I mean, Reputation came out of everything, and it is probably my number one album from her entire discography.
A lot of people say that, and I noticed too at the concert, I think that's the one that people go crazy over the most. Like, when Reputation, like, starts the intro starts playing on the screen, like, people lose their mind.
The Snakes. And the reason why
it's definitely her most popular album.
Yes. The reason why the Snakes happen is because Kim kept calling her a snake. And so she fucking delved right into that shit. Mm-hmm. And yeah,
she keeps wearing her snake green dresses lately.
She does, because that one has not been released as a re-recording yet. She only
But I kept thinking it was gonna happen. I thought maybe happen on New Year's Day.
We're all clowning.
I thought it was gonna happen on her birthday. Then I thought it was gonna happen on New Year's Day.
Yep.
Some people I wonder what she's waiting for.
Some people are thinking February 11th now. I don't know.
I think she's just trying to troll us.
I think she was trying to give 1989 its glory for a while. But that was what, October, bitch? October 27th? Yeah. Why do I remember this? Because I was watching the announcement live.
Well, Speak Now came out, what, in the summer?
Yeah, I want to say it was summer. There were two or three that came out this past year, bitch. Good shit.
I know, they all came out pretty fast.
Yeah, good.
Because I feel like Fearless and Speak Now, didn't they come out like a year apart? And then all of a sudden it was like,
bam, 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 bam. Yeah, so maybe she's trying to slow it down a little bit and maybe like, oh, I only have two left.
I mean, come on with these.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Make that money,
with,
girl.
With these outfits, though, she's definitely trying.
Oh, she's trolling for sure.
She's fucking with us.
Oh, yeah, she's trolling.
She went to Spago a couple, like, last weekend, weekends ago, and that I have some coworkers that work there because it's right.
Is that the one where she was with Britney?
Yes.
I was wondering right where that was. The
Golden Globes or
something. Yes, I was wondering where that was.
Some of my coworkers work there because it's right across the street from where I work. I won't say where I work, but
yes, I love that.
They told me that, I guess when they went in, they had the private dining room all set up for her. And they, like, called their florist. They, like, made it all perfect. They had all these flowers arrangements. They made it look amazing for her to come in. And it was just a table of four.
Yeah.
And it was just her and three other girls.
Yeah.
And I guess when Taylor walked in, she was like, no, I don't want to sit here. She was like, I want to be out where the people are.
Really?
She said she didn't want to be in the private room.
Wow.
And so it was, like, literally, like, Spago, if you don't know, is, like, one of the, like, most popular fine dining restaurants in Los Angeles. It's in Beverly Hills.
Yeah.
And so it was a busy Saturday night, so they were all booked up.
Yeah.
And so I guess they were scrambling to try to figure out where the fuck to put her, because they were like, okay, we were planning on putting you in the fucking private dining room.
Yeah.
And so I guess they had to figure out, they put her out on the fucking, like, patio for everyone to watch her.
No.
So, but this is the thing, is to me, I'm like, why did she want that?
Yeah.
So obviously she wants to be seen right now.
Yeah.
She knows what she's doing. Paparazzi'd.
Yeah.
Her refusing to sit in a private room. She wanted everyone to watch her while she was there.
You get in those moods, you know, where you don't want to be seen.
But she's clearly got something up her sleeve. Why does she want to be watched so much?
And why did she want people to see that outfit she was wearing? Because it was reputation themed, you know? Yeah.
So I find it interesting.
Yeah.
Because I don't know. I just think that everything she's doing right now, she's getting photographed everywhere she goes right now.
Oh, yeah.
And if you remember, like, I mean, it's with celebrities, I've learned now after, like, living in LA and working in Beverly Hills for the last couple of years, I realize now that when a celebrity is seen and photographed, it's because they want to be seen.
Oh, yeah.
It's not because, oh, everyone's following me, leave me alone. It's because they want to be seen.
Most of the time, their people call the pops themselves.
When Taylor is photographed, it's because she wants to be photographed. Yeah. Unless it's those photos where she's, like, at the airport and she's covering herself. Like, I think that's the only time she doesn't really want to be seen. And you can tell when you watch those videos of her, she's, like, posing. She's, like, she's looking behind her shoulder.
There's specific ways she's looking. Oh, yeah, every time.
So she's planning something. She wants to be seen for a reason. I think that the album's probably going to drop. But obviously, I don't know if you've read, there's lots of theories online, too, of, like, the Missing Karma album being released.
Yes.
And, or just, like, another album in general.
Yeah.
And it's not actually going to be Reputation. It's going to just be another album, because people
are saying,
I would fucking
lose my shit.
There's, like, a cycle. What is it? Like, two.
Every 2 years. Yeah.
They're saying it's, like, what did she do? Two re-records and then a regular album, album. I don't know. She's in some sort of cycle. But
yeah. Okay.
Who knows? I think she's got something up her sleeve, though.
Yeah. I would lose it.
Some tea.
That is tea. I like this.
Some tea.
I will say, if I saw her out and about bitch.
Oh, I know. I was so mad because I was working that day and like Spago was literally right across the street from where yards. I work. I was like crying because I was like, I got cut early that day, and I'm like, I see the photos the next day. I'm like, oh my god, I was like breathing the same air.
It's crazy that you said that because I literally was like online at like 2 a.m. looking at those photos. It was like her, Brittany Mahomes, and like a couple other friends, and I literally was like, where the fuck is that green dumpster? Where's this? Where's that? Where is she?
That's so funny. Yeah.
And then nobody said where it was. So I immediately
texted my coworker. I was like, you need to tell me everything.
I love that. I can't believe she did not want to be in the private room. I love that the floor is.
But isn't that weird? Because most celebrities, like people who come into like my restaurant.
Yeah.
They usually want to be hidden.
And by the way, it's been cold as fuck in LA lately. Mm-hmm. So like, why, girl, you're on the patio? Like, you're okay with this?
She wanted that.
Yeah. Interesting. Yeah. Very interesting, bitch. That's wild. But no, dude, let's get into our faves and our not so faves of the Reputation era.
Okay.
2017, baby. I remember what I was doing when that that single came out. I was actually dog sitting, like in the Pasadena area, mm-hmm. and when "Look What You Made Me Do" came out, I was like, "This song is not good." And then, like,
I know
I
cringed a little bit.
I cringed a little bit when it came out.
The dancing, the slapping of the thighs, it was a little cringy.
I was like, "What is this?" Yeah,
and but then, it grew on me.
But bitch, once the rest of the album came out,
the rest of the album was so good,
good.
I think that I feel like it's important to say that, like, I feel like I was very anti her being pop because I felt like at the time I was such a red girl that I felt like she was selling out a little bit.
Okay,
and I feel like it wasn't until like Folklore, Evermore, Midnights came out that I started to be able to go back and appreciate her pop eras because I'm like, okay, she knows how to like switch it up.
Yeah.
She's not just doing pop now.
I can see that.
So I feel like I've grown to love Reputation a lot more now, which is funny because I feel like a lot of people, that's just the album that they fell in love with.
Right.
But I think for me, my favorite is probably Getaway Car.
Really?
I had trouble trying to figure out what my favorite was. But really? I think it's just so fun. It's like, a game. It's like a classic Taylor Jack Antonoff song.
Yeah. Oh, for sure.
It's got that bridge. It's just like, nothing gets that than a getaway car.
And do you think that's about Tom Hiddleston and how she was trying to break up with Calvin Harris? She was pretty much saying, like, I needed to break up with this guy. Give me a reason to do it.
Yeah, definitely. You know? Like, I just feel like when you hear, like, took the money in the bag
and I stole the keys. That was the last time you ever saw me.
Yep. It's just it's a good bridge.
It is. Yeah. No, for sure. That is a good one. I do like that one a lot.
I also love, like, Delicate. I think that was a great
Delicate's
single.
So good.
It was cute. I loved that song. And then
I love the music video. I love the Golden Gopher where they filmed that.
I know, we used to go there after work sometimes, actually, in our my downtown days.
They actually filmed some
of
it.
I think I went there with you. No,
for my birthday, maybe, question mark, because I maybe. Went there for my birthday.
I went there a few times when I used to work down there.
Huh. They definitely did some of that music video at the Biltmore Hotel downtown. Mm. And I like tried doing like a little ghost hunting thing there too. And I like tried to.
Really?
I tried to recreate her little moves and shit. Yeah.
That's funny.
That's a great, great fucking song.
Yeah.
I'm glad that was a single. I'm very glad.
I also love I Did Something Bad.
Yeah. That one's good.
King of My Heart.
King of My Heart, I hate. I don't know what it is about King of My Heart. I am not a fan, bro.
Yeah. I think maybe it grew on me, actually.
Yeah. There's something about that one, and This Is Why We Can't Have Nice Things that I just can't stand.
Yes, This Is Why I Can't Have Nice Things is like my least favorite song for sure.
Really?
I think it's just like, just shut up.
Definitely about Kanye.
It's definitely about Kanye. But I just feel like every time I hear it, I'm like, I don't care.
Yeah, yeah. It's like, well, I don't care. You fucked it up, bro. This Is Why We Can't Have Nice Things. You fucked it up.
Yeah.
But honestly, my number one out of this entire album is call it what you want. Mm. Not gonna lie.
I do love that song.
That one is number one. It is so underrated. People don't realize. It's such a
cute song.
It's so good. It's just so good. It's whimsical. My it's good. My
babies fit like a daydream. I'm walking too.
Yes. It's just so good. And she's obviously talking about, I'm assuming either Tom or Joe.
I think it's for sure Joe.
I think it's Joe because she's talking about how they're like, you know.
This is like finally flying. Joe enters this the picture.
This is when I was just going to say, when Joe finally enters. But dude, dancing with her hands tied, incredible.
Well, I don't know though at the same time.
You don't like that
Joe,
one?
No, was Joe in the picture at that time?
He was.
Because when I was doing like because when I was they, when I was writing Joe. My notes for this, I was like looking at it and it said I think she started dating him like right when the album came out though,
but she also met him the exact same day allegedly that she met Tom Hiddleston. Crazy, right? At the Met Gala. Yeah, bitch.
Interesting.
I know, right?
Color what you want. Yeah, color what you want to.
Yeah. Ugh, it's just ugh, the production.
It definitely sounds like a Joe song, though. All the jokers dressing up as kings. They fade to nothing when I look at him.
Bridges burn, I never learn. At least I did one thing right. That's my favorite.
I did one thing right.
Ooh, this part, too.
I'm laughing with my lover, making force undercover. Trust him like a brother, yeah, I know I did one thing right.
Oh, I love it. Oh, it's so Stars good. Darkest night. The lyrics of Gorgeous are not my favorite. It's kind of like you could have done better, in my opinion. You know what I
but
mean?
But I also relate to
I do relate verse. To it. I do relate to
I also relate to that lyric so much. I was like, you're so gorgeous, I can't say anything to your face.
Yes. Like, that one's definitely about Joe. We gotta love the Blake Lively love and how she uses her kid in the beginning.
Gorgeous. Dancing with Her Hands Tied is also an underrated one.
Dude, Dancing with Her Hands Tied is just so good. It's so good. How has that not become, like, anything big? I don't know what it is about that one. New Year's Day, you can't go wrong with that one. That one's cute. Just, you know, we're going
to wait for the vault tracks on this, though.
Oh, bitch.
They're going to be fucking insane.
I'm going to lose my mind.
I think that's why she's doing so much, like, weird paparazzi press. Because I think she's... Because why the paparazzi? And you think about paparazzi, it plays... It's paparazzi is reputation, right?
It
plays into the theme of reputation.
Yeah.
And so I just think that these vault songs are going to be fucking
dude
wild. They're probably going to be some of her best songs.
Everyone thought she was going to release like 10 for 1989. Bitch, you better release 10 for at least for a Reputation. Mm-hmm. Like, but like just the beginning of this album, like how iconic, like
ready for it. Yeah. Are you ready for it, bitch?
Right. Oh, so good. Like, really getting you ready. Like, literally.
Yeah, it just pumps you up.
Are you ready for it?
Like, oh, it's so good.
I will say, like, she tried to dance so much during this
She did. Album she did.
And this tour. And it was a little, like, even just, like, the Reputation tour movie that's, like, on Netflix and stuff. Like, some of them, like, oh, girl. She's just not the greatest dancer, but.
Right. I mean, she tries, for sure.
She tries.
But, like, I just think, like, some of these moves, yeah, for sure, need to be, like, tailored a little
Don't
bit.
Don't blame
LOL
me.
LOL tailored.
Another good one.
Yeah.
Don't blame me.
Oh, I thought you were going to say Don't Blame Me. Like, this is another good one. And then, like, give me the title. But I forgot. Don't Blame Me is so good. I do like that one a lot. So It Goes is cute. I like that one, too. Dress is okay.
Yeah.
I mean, I get it. Like, she's all, like, that's when she, you know,
that was the first one. She was like, okay, I'm going to let you know.
Yeah. I like
to bought this dress. You would take it off.
Let's fuck. I want you to put your name in my fucking headboard or whatever it was.
I know.
Yeah. No, that was pretty good. I did like that one.
She said, like, her mom can't listen to it.
Yes.
Kind of song.
Yep. I went to this tour. This was the first time, question mark, that I saw Taylor, or maybe second, because I went to the Jingle Ball in, like, I want to say 2017.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And she was the, like, the headliner. So she was the last one to put go on. And I saw her then. And then I went to the Reputation Tour in, like, 2018. And it's so much different compared to the Eras Tour. Like, I went with our friend Michael. And it was pretty easy to get tickets. I mean, we had to do the whole verified fan thing, but it was at the Rose Bowl and it was pretty good seats for like maybe $200-something. And lo and behold, Eras Tour, how many years later? Jesus Christ, you're lucky, you know, you're lucky to even get a ticket.
I know. Well, that's also another thing is that she didn't tour.
Yeah. For how long?
Because for so COVID, many years.
Yeah.
Between COVID, she also... Her mom got sick when she released Lover, so she didn't want to go on tour.
Yep.
So she had, like, what, 4 albums that she hadn't toured.
Yeah.
The last tour was what, Reputation?
Yeah, Reputation was the last tour.
So she had Lover, Folklore, Evermore, and Midnights.
Yeah, she had a lot to cover.
So, I mean, of course, everyone went fucking crazy.
And you can't even do it justice at all. Like, you could do an entire tour for each album, man. Mm-hmm. Like... Yeah, like they usually do, but no. Yeah, so that's why, like, it was just so exciting when, you know, the tour did finally come around. But, yeah, Reputation is, I don't know what it is about that album, but it is fucking iconic. And I can't believe it didn't win a single Grammy. Like, holy shit. And, like, in her documentary, she's like, well, I just have to make something better. And it's like, bitch, like, I know, you're doing, like, great. Crying. I'm you're like, doing great.
That's what I know. Whenever I see that, I just, like, want to shake her through the screen. Yes. And be like, girl, it does not matter.
No. Like,
why does she care so much about this fucking Grammy? You think your fellow pop stars are getting nominated every year,
oh,
girl?
Yeah.
Like,
oh, yeah.
No, they are not.
I mean, let's be real. I don't think she, I was going to say, hopefully she learned from it, but no, dude, like everybody still wants
to. No, I think
Grammy.
She had like this obsession.
Yeah.
Of, I think she just wanted to prove to people.
Yeah.
That she was like a great artist.
Yeah. And like the amount of Grammys you have.
Because then if you, when you watch, when you watch Miss Americana, it's just like,
yes.
She, like the scene where she's like, God, that's all you ever wanted. That's all you ever wanted. When she finally does get it.
Yeah.
And it's like.
No,
she's like, now what? Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like, yeah, girl, that's not everything.
Damn straight.
But, yeah.
I feel like I could talk about that album forever, but
I know.
We'll move
on. But what
on.
I find interesting, though, I just want to say is Calvin Harris.
Yeah.
Because I just feel like when I was looking up like people she dated and how long, like she dated him for like 2 years.
Yeah.
And a lot of her songs are on Reputation are about him.
Yeah.
But yeah, like, I feel like we also don't know.
Yeah, we don't know
anything.
All the story at all.
But I feel like with other boyfriends, we know a lot.
Yeah.
I feel like we really get into the nitty gritty of a lot of her other relationships where with Calvin Harris, I'm like, what was that?
Yeah.
But I almost feel like she's trying to tell us, like, that's how I felt too.
And she,
she's like, I don't know what that was either.
She did post that one photo, like, on their first year anniversary, like, with the cake that said #1 on it. And she looked all cute and excited. And it's like, we never really saw anything after that, you know? So, yeah, it's kind of like, what the fuck happened, you know?
Yeah.
That is interesting. Yeah.
It's just, I feel like the one relationship I'm like, have a question mark next to. I'm like, what was, I don't really know.
Yeah.
What she felt about him. Like, what, did she really like him? Like, I don't.
Right.
But I don't really think she did.
Hmm.
And because, but even in, like, some of these Midnight songs, I feel like she's saying, like, I didn't really like you. I feel like she just dated him for.
Because he's cute. The press. I mean, he's definitely cute.
Yeah. I feel like she just really wanted to be, like, in a power couple.
I wonder if accents really are that powerful.
I think they are. They're powerful to me.
I agree.
They
I mean, if you have like some sort of like European accent, like you're automatically a cuter, you know?
I mean
it's
like that,
that's shallow, but
it's like in Love Actually, the guy who's like, I'm going to America because none of the girls here like me, and he's like, as soon as I go to America, they're gonna fall in love with me. And then he's like dating like Denise Richards. And he's like some ugly Brit. They're like, oh my God, you have an accent? I'm like, but it's true. Like, I feel like that's how it.
That's how it works.
You're British, you're hot.
Yeah, like pretty much, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yep, damn straight.
I get it. #London boy.
Yes, we'll get to London boy next.
Yeah.
I really thought that we would be able to get through all of this in one episode, but oh my gosh, I don't think we're going to be able to. So stick around for part two, guys. It will be coming soon. You don't want to miss it because there are plenty more Taylor Swift eras to go through. So thank you so much for listening to Unwomanly. Make sure to follow Unwomanly at Unwomanly Podcast on Instagram. Make sure to check out the merch that I've got out. We've got even more coming out. Very exciting things happening in 2024. But don't forget to come back for part two of the eras of Taylor Swift with Alexa. Thank you so much. We'll see you next time here on Unwomanly.